It's a few thousand over capacity. Tickets along University Boulevard, I'm told, go from about $100 a pop. We'll talk coming up about the Florida receivers. These guys will have predictions on this game as well as the Miami-Virginia Tech game. But now it's time to turn the microphones over to our loyal fans and see if anybody in the Big Orange or Gator Nation have questions for these two guys. Question number one.
Hey, Lee, my name is Jen, and my question was, do you think the postponement of the game benefits Florida or Tennessee?
Oh, I think because of Rex Grossman's ability to play right now, I think it helps Florida, plus a sense of urgency. Florida wins this ball game, they got a chance to go to the Rose Bowl. I think Florida gets the advantage.
All right, you agree?
Well, I think there you can look at it either way. Casey Clawson now is a different quarterback as well, and Tennessee's offense is completely different now than they were early in the year.
And much healthier than they would have been had they played in September, as Tony pointed out. Question number two.
Hey, Kirk, I was just wondering, since this is Casey Clawson's first time in the Swamp, how much of an effect do you think the Swamp's atmosphere is going to have on him?
Great question. I think that's the key to the football game. How Casey Clawson, who's been playing much better in the last four games, handles this atmosphere, this crowd, and a defense, it is going to be at a different level when it comes to intensity. If they can protect him, that's the key. Can they protect him? They've got a chance to hit some big plays. They've got great receivers.
You never forget your first visit to the Swamp, right?
Never.
This is tough. I'm glad I didn't have to play because I was getting screamed at.
Well, he's not going to have any ability to communicate it to Lyon. Yeah, it's tough.
Question number three.
Nicholson, and this is Crystal Waters. Tennessee's defense struggled against Kentucky. We just want to know how you think that their secondary is going to fare against Rex Grossman and our wide receivers.
I think she said something about Tennessee's secondary.
Yeah.
Forget about it. Ooh. There ain't no way they're going to stop Florida's receivers, except if they keep the football, keep those guys on the bench, then they got a chance.
The only way you can stop their receivers is if you get pressure on Rex Grossman. And the way Florida's system is, they get rid of the ball so quick, it's tough to do. I'll tell you, it's going to be tough to stop those guys today.
We thank folks all season for their questions, but you know, I never got a question all year. Nobody ever asked me a single question.
Because you don't make any predictions.
Devin, do you have a question for me?
Where's Frank?
Somebody has a question.
You get nothing.
All right.
You
we'll
get
be right
no
back.
Loving.
We'll take a look. Saturn hopes you enjoy the view from high above. Well, Rex Grossman, an amazing combination of stats. Number one in passing efficiency, as well as number one in total offense. That's a rare combination. In fact, he's number one in just about every stat. But today will be his first pass attempt ever against Tennessee. He wants to utter the same phrase Jesse Palmer did in the huddle before last year's game-winning drive. Fellas, let's make some memories. That drive capped by this very controversial touchdown grab by Jabbar Gaffney. Spurrier's words, God smiled on the Gators that day, Tony. But what most folks forget is that capped a 91-yard game-winning drive that was very clutch. That play, certainly the emergence of Jabbar Gaffney.
Oh, there's no question about it. Now, matter of fact, in 1996, Florida won a national championship with three receivers who became so revered they were simply known as Ike, Riedel, and Quezzy. Well, the Gators are back in the national championship picture, but this time it is Jabbar, Riche, and Taylor who believe it is their turn to carve out their place in Florida football history.
My name is Jabbar Gaffney. I'm also known as the Reaper.
My name is Taylor Jacobs. I'm also known as Zeus.
My name is Riche Caldwell, also known as the Bad Guy.
Get into their head and I just take their soul during the process of a game.
I'm probably the strongest and the fastest and got all the power.
That's his name, you know, I like. So that's what I went with.
This season, Gaffney, Caldwell, and Jacobs have accounted for 150 catches, almost 2,700 yards, and 29 touchdowns. Their productivity is strikingly similar, if not better, than the 1996 trio of Ike Hilliard, Riedel Anthony, and Jacquez Green. The gold standard by which all Florida receivers are measured.
They're probably the best here as a unit. I mean, all three of those guys did things that, I mean, you can only dream about doing out there on the football field.
It was just one person they were trying to get the ball to. You know, Coach Spurrier just throw those three out there and say, you know, hey, let's get in the end zone. And that's what we're trying to do, too.
Preseason, we watched the 1996 tapes and 95 tapes of the receivers and quarterbacks and how they did it because they wanted us to emulate them.
Jabbar, very similar to Ike Hilliard in regards to, you know, putting his foot in the ground and making separation from a defensive back. Riche is a lot similar to Riedel, you know. He can make people miss with the short pass. He is a very athletic type of receiver. Taylor Jacobs, a lot similar to Jaquez, you know, with his bursting speed. People respect the speed, give him a little bit more room, and he can run the ball down.
But going into the 2001 season, Gaffney and Caldwell were the only known quantities in the wide receiver ranks. But as history shows, Florida's passing game doesn't really click until a third comes along. Enter Taylor Jacobs.
I was inconsistent, as everybody knows. But the main thing that's helped me is, you know, knowing that I can go out there and I don't have anything to lose.
With his speed, you got to respect him going deeper. And if you get playing him, start playing him like he's going deep, he can stop on the dime and just make you look silly out there.
To put those three receivers in with a Coach Spurrier offense, it's bound to work out.
As a group, the threesome has become close to unstoppable, because each brings a little something different to the table.
Jabbar's just smooth, you know, he gets open.
You got Riche, gonna take you deep and make you miss. Agile.
Taylor Jacob just, you know, nobody can run with him. He's just probably the fastest guy on the field in every game we play.
How good can these guys be?
As good as any receiver quarterback that I ever seen together.
Oh, they're pretty close, Tony, to Ike, Riedel, and Quezzy when they were here. You know, I hate to make the call, which group's better than the other. They're just pretty close.
Now, through 10 games this season, this group has 33 more catches and 493 more yards than that group in 1996. And here's the kicker. Jabbar Gaffney is a sophomore. The other two guys are juniors. And, Coach, if they all come back next year, the numbers they could put up would be incredible.
Yep. And how about that young quarterback? Not bad. You know, defensive coaches used to say, to beat old Steve Spurrier and the Florida Gators, all you have to do is make him drive the ball a long way, and he'll make mistakes and get impatient. That was before Rex Grossman. Now listen to this. This is what Florida did last week against the beloved Florida State Seminoles. They had drives of 90, 82, and 85 yards for touchdowns. Yo, is that good or what? Now here's old Rex, number 8. Watch him in shotgun against the goal line. Yeah, keep your eye. They sent all the receivers out, and old Rex just finds the open way, and he hits them right here. Touchdown. But this is against South Carolina a couple of weeks ago when we saw him scramble. Now, this is the one thing that Rex Grossman is doing better than other people thinks, that he can run the football. Now, I'm going to have to read this because this is an amazing stat. Listen to this, please. Rex Grossman has had 2,465 yards passing, 23 touchdowns just in the first half this year. That's more than Dorsey and Harrington have the entire games.
Yo.
That's a double yo, boy. Is that good?
That's a triple yo.
Yeah, triple
yo. You know,
yo.
He don't even need the second half to put up his big numbers. Let's look at Tennessee's offense. They've been getting a little bit better these last few weeks because they've been healthier. Casey Clawson's playing with a lot of confidence, but the key will be, can Tennessee's offensive line protect Clawson, and how will he respond when he sees a defense and an atmosphere that he's never seen his entire career as a starting quarterback at Tennessee? The guy to watch is Alex Brown. We remember 2 years ago at the Swamp, Alex Brown was unstoppable. He had 5 sacks in that game. Seemed to be getting off the ball that day better than the offensive lineman. Now, last year, Alex Brown was handled. He didn't have a sack. They double-teamed him most of the game. My question is, which Alex Brown will show up in this football game? I think he's going to be pretty aggressive today. I think the crowd will be a huge factor in this game. Tennessee cannot afford to be conservative or predictable with their play calling, or this atmosphere will overwhelm that offense.
Got to survive the first minutes. Got to survive the end of the first half. That's been a very critical time for Tennessee in these games. And I think they got to score touchdowns and not field goals. Field goals are not going to win this thing for them. I agree with you. Florida in the red zone has been awesome. In the next 3 hours, Penn State can secure a bowl bid if they can beat Virginia. We'll be back here, but a preview now, Steve Levy and TC in Charlottesville.
Physically and mentally, they've been for a long time for a Florida game. But the Gator players told me this all week. He said, since Auburn, we have been totally focused. And, Kirk, that's why the Gators get it done today, and they move on to the SEC championship.
You look at Florida having an opportunity to get a second life because of the loss last week to Nebraska and Oklahoma. Florida comes in with a lot on the line, the atmosphere. This is not going to be a close game. Florida will win in a big, big way.
Oh, God, give it to me.
And here comes another visit from Albert the Alligator. He showed up in Columbia, and it was a big Gator victory.
Usually he does the mole chop.
We thank you for joining us, Tony. Lee Kirk, it's been a terrific regular season of College Game. And we'll see you January 3rd from Pasadena. Meanwhile, we're back here all afternoon on ESPN. You enjoy the ball game, the Cavaliers and the Nittany Lions, right now on ESPN.
And right behind them, this a moment ago, the 9-1 fourth-ranked Tennessee Volunteers. It's Tennessee, Florida meeting for the 31st time this game with SEC and national championship implications. The winner of this game goes to the SEC championship next week. Ready for kickoff? Alex Walls will kick off for Tennessee, Florida. Deep, Lito Shepherd and Kewan Ratliff. Lito Shepherd averaging 22.4 this season. Nailed it. Kewan Ratliff backs up 7 yards deep. Touchback. And Florida will get their most potent offense in the country underway early on. Vern Lundquist along with Todd Blackledge. Well, we've been waiting for this one for a while, postponed from September. What do you see as key in this one?
I think one simple thing, whichever defensive front seven, two best defenses in the conference, whichever one can dictate the flow of the game, that'll determine who wins this football game. And Tennessee on defense first. Philip Fulmer told me this. He said, one team's band is going to play really fast in this game because we are coming after Rex Grossman.
And Grossman will go from the shotgun on first down and 10 from the 20. Essentially an eight-man front. Here's Grossman back. Here comes the pressure. Rashad Moore. And the pass is dropped by Jabbar Graffney. Winner of this one goes into the SEC championship next Saturday night. Later this evening, Auburn and LSU will play in Baton Rouge. So those of you who are non-BCS proponents, here's your playoff.
Yep.
Rex Grossman for the season has now become among the top five candidates for the Heisman Trophy, though he is but a sophomore. Right side, pass caught. It's Gaffney, nailed as he gets to the 28-yard line. Third down and two, the tackle made by Teddy Gaines. And offensively up front for the Florida Gators, it's Pearson, Snell, Zadalis, and the others. Gillespie starts for an injured Ernest Graham. Gaffney, Caldwell, Aaron Walker is the tight end. Taylor Jacobs is the third wide receiver.
And right away you see where they might miss Ernest Graham in short yardage situations like this. I think that's where he was at his best.
Third down and one.
Check off.
Draw play. There's where they miss Ernest Graham. Three and out. Will Overstreet with the tackle.
Boy, he just made a quick move off the ball, a stunt inside. Watch Overstreet stunt right inside and stop this play. He plays with a great motor. He gets inside position and just beat Mike Pearson, the best offensive lineman inside.
Matt Leach will punt on fourth down. Had a tough night 2 weeks ago against Florida State. This one will bounce as Dante Stallworth back to return lets it roll, and Tennessee will take over after forcing Florida three and out. 38-yard punt, nothing on the return, and we introduce the third member of our team. Here's Jill Arrington.
Well, Vernon, talking to the coaches this week, it seems that Tennessee may have come out on top of delaying this game for 2 months. Number one, they're healthier. They would have played back in September. They would have had four guys who were injured. Dante Stallworth, Parker Henderson would have been out, and Bartholomew was not 100%. But now they're back, and Kelly Washington has had a whole season playing receiver. And Casey Clawson, well,
on first down, here's Clawson across the middle. Stallworth, big gain, Tennessee. On first and 10, that's a pickup of 18.
Well, Jill's exactly right. This is a much different Tennessee football team right now with a healthy Dante Stallworth and Kelly Washington, who is now a mature wide receiver. Casey Clawson kind of struggled early in the year, but as of late, playing great at the quarterback position because they are dangerous on both sides of the offense.
Stallworth out on first down and 10. And Bobby Graham, the possession receiver, has taken his place. This is the season graphics for Casey Clawson.
Nice job of communicating.
just does beat the play clock. Travis Stevens as a flag flies.
And let's check the first penalty of this ball game.
Before the ball was snapped, movement by the offensive line, 5 yards to a first down.
Now you've been introduced to Casey Clawson. Let's check the rest of the offensive line. Up front, Coleman, Weary, Wells, Herrera, Stevens and Bartholomew, along with Stallworth, Parker, and Finlayson as the tight end. First and 15.
Reggie Coleman, a key guy to left tackle, sat out last week's game.
Alex Brown jumped. He may have come across. Here's Bobby Graham with a catch, and Gus Scott hauls him down. But let's check and see if Brown came across or was drawn across.
Well, 2 years ago, Alex Brown became an All-American against Tennessee with 5 sacks. And in that game, he was tipped off somehow to the snap count. And he was getting a tremendous jump off the ball.
Second down.
And Randy Sanders told us, we can't allow that to happen. We've got to change up the snap counts. We've got to change the looks for him. Here's Alex right here. See, he's trying to guess. He's trying to get an early jump because he did it so well 2 years ago.
Having declined the penalty at second down and 3 from the 41. It's Jason Witten, the lead block, and Travis Stevens.
Nice run.
Picks up the first down to the 36-yard line before Todd Johnson makes the tackle. And this vastly improved Florida defense from 1 year ago. This is the way they'll line up. Lee, Scott, LeFevre, Alex Brown, Nateel, Davis, the key for them, Byron Hartman, and in the secondary, Shepard, Johnson, Marquand Manuel, and Benny Alexander.
And if you had to describe John Hoke's defense in one word, it would be fast. And when they play fast, that's when they play best.
Derek Tinsley in the backfield now, the freshman running back for Tennessee. First and 10, Clawson with time, deep down the middle for the tight end, Jason Witten, and he is knocked down by Gus Scott, number 9.
If Florida wants to play cover 2, if they want to try to double coverage, the wide receivers, the tight end has to be a factor in the middle. He's open. This is not a great throw by Clawson. You don't want to hang your guy up in the middle like that. Make him stretch out. He's got a height advantage on Gus Scott. Scott's only 5'10", and Witten is a big guy. Casey has to get that ball down for him.
Both wide receivers come wide left on second and 10. Backs in the eye. Little dart to the left. And the tackle made by Andre Davis, middle linebacker. And Darrell Lee, number 86.
When I talked about the front 7, which front 7 could dictate the flow of the game, it comes in 2 packages. One is stopping the run, and these two are the best 2 in the conference at defending the run. The other is pressuring the quarterback.
We welcome those of you joining us at the Swamp, having watched basketball, Tennessee, Florida, just underway. Florida went 3 and out, punted. This is Tennessee's first offensive possession of the ball game. And having not agreed with what he saw, Casey Clawson calls timeout. So the timeout comes with 11 minutes and 5 seconds remaining in the opening quarter of play. Florida at home against Tennessee. We'll catch our breath and be right back.
Welcome back to the Swamp, the first early quarter. Significant down, 3rd and 8, Tennessee at the 35, and 5 DBs in for the Florida Gators.
Tight end over here to help on Alex Brown. Good choice.
Clawson from the shotgun, draw play. And Stevens comes left, bounces off a tackle, and that is close for the first down at the 28-yard line. Gus Scott, Todd Johnson finally got there.
You know, one thing about him, we talked to Travis before the game or yesterday, and when he came over to talk with us, I mean, he is really small. I mean, he's put together pretty well, but he's short, and he's able to kind of just squat down and hide in behind these linemen. Watch him stay low and just kind of bounce around in there. He's had an outstanding year. His story is a great story.
Randy Sanders, the defensive coordinator, told us in a conference call on Wednesday night, we want to get their safeties involved. It's 4th down, and they will go for it. You see the graphic on Stevens here. 4th and 1, backs in the eye. Stevens got it inside the 25. Philip Fulmer
What a confidence boost. A confidence boost for this Tennessee football team, taking the ball right behind their two best linemen, Reggie Coleman on the left tackle and Fred Weary, the left guard. And if Andre Davis doesn't make the tackle, this might go for a touchdown. Watch Davis able to get around the legs of Travis Stevens. But great position for Tennessee. And remember, last year they moved the ball and had to kick field goals. They need to score touchdowns.
Clawson will throw on first and 10. Comes short. He's got a diving try at the 15-yard line. And the catch is made by John Finlayson, a three-time academic SEC player. That's only his third catch of the year.
Yeah, that's a nice play call by Randy Sanders. You put the tight end on the opposite side of the dangerous wide receivers, and it's not the tight end you throw to. Jason Witten is the guy you throw to. And so a good call that time by Sanders to get the ball to Finlayson.
Second down and one. Bobby Graham and Dante Stallworth break off wide right. Bartholomew the lead back in front of Travis Stevens on second and one. Here's Stevens, and he plows forward. That should be enough to move the chain again. Well, Philip Fulmer played for Tennessee back in the late 60s, early 70s. Now in his 10th season, 2-7 versus Florida and 35-2 against the rest of the East. He was part of the last team of Volunteers that won here in Gainesville. It goes back to 1971. They're 0-7 since then. First and 10, Tennessee trying to take an early lead. Play action into the right flat, caught by Bobby Graham. And Marquand Manuel, the fifth-year senior, makes the tackle.
I really think for Tennessee, if Florida is going to concentrate their defensive efforts on Washington and Stallworth, the two guys that have to emerge and be playmakers are Bobby Graham and Jason Witten, the tight end. And so far, Randy Sanders doing a nice job of spreading the football out to some guys that don't get it that much.
Todd, you mentioned last year's game, which was played in Knoxville. Tennessee in the first half, four Alex Walls field goals.
Right. Move the ball up and down the field, but you don't beat Florida with field goals.
Here's the handoff. This is Troy Fleming, number 27, in as a lone back. Well, Florida and Tennessee, each with 6-1 conference records. The hiccup for Florida came at Auburn. The hiccup for Tennessee against Georgia at home. As it turns out, those games relatively meaningless because it all comes down to this one. Winner goes in to the SEC championship.
And you know, neither team likes to lose a game, but both teams, I think, refocused after their loss and kind of got better as each week progressed from that point.
Third and one. Jabari Davis has come in.
The big back, 230-pounder.
Quarterback keeper Clawson. And again, it would appear that he got enough to move the chain.
Did a nice job of staying low on that quarterback sneak, just driving right in behind his center, Scott Wells. I like what I see out of Casey Clawson right now. He's playing with poise and confidence. He's managing the offense. He's making good decisions of where to throw the football. And he's got his team. And remember, he told us yesterday, when we get our opportunities, we must take advantage. They've got an opportunity right now.
First and goal. Here's the toss right. Travis Stevens gets a block from Troy Fleming, but then nice defensive pursuit as he is strung out laterally and picks up one.
Mike Natale is a linebacker that has really come on for John Hoke's defense. One of those guys that can really run on the outside. He's a junior. He's been playing since he was a freshman, but he's really developed, as you can say that about a lot of these Florida defenders. They played when they were early. They weren't a great defense, but they have been an outstanding defense this season.
Second down and goal. Backs in the eye. Play fake. Clawson has a man. Touchdown, Troy Fleming. That's his second touchdown catch of the year.
Poised by the quarterback. Sell the fake. Florida thinking run. Casey Clawson does a nice job of selling the run fake. Watch the fake right in here to Travis Stevens. Hide the ball. Good fake. Now you got two guys open. Finlayson or Fleming. He chooses the easier throw and a nice drive for Tennessee.
Troy Fleming bobbled it, then got it. There's Travis Stevens. He was a very significant part
and then gave way at the end to this big fullback, Troy Fleming.
Troy Fleming is a bigger guy. He's out of the backfield, excellent hands, and Casey Clawson gets Tennessee on the board first.
Troy Fleming gets the touchdown toss from an ice-cool Casey Clawson in Tennessee. Strikes first. Fleming's two-yard touchdown, a 66-yard drive, and took nearly half the first quarter.
And that's the key. I mean, the more they're on the field, the less Steve Spurrier's offense is on the field. So it couldn't have started any better for Philip Fulmer's team.
Alex Walls will kick off for the second time. Ratliff and Shepard await the kickoff, and this will be Kewan Ratliff at the 7-yard line. Heads left, pretty good pursuit. Excellent pursuit by the Tennessee kickoff coverage team. Tackle made by number 25, Tony Campbell. Now we talked about the Florida offense. Let's take a look at this Tennessee defense, which in itself is a very good unit. And they've got a healthy front four. Bernard Jackson, John Henderson, an Outland finalist again. Albert Hainsworth and Will Overstreet. Stevenson in the middle. Kevin Burnett on the outside. And in the secondary, they will be tested. It's Gaines and Baker, Battle and Jabari Greer.
They've got to take the challenge. They got to get up right in the face of these receivers and challenge them and hope that the pressure comes through inside.
Grossman has time, comes right. He's got a man wide open, Reese Caldwell. So the first and 10 strike by Florida gives them an 18-yard gain.
The Florida's pass offense, the reason it's the best in the country is because there's so much about timing, and it starts with protection. And if you let him get into a rhythm, Rex Grossman, that is, he will pick any defense apart. These receivers are impossible to cover for long periods of time. And if you can't get to the quarterback, he will spread the ball all over the place. And the development of Caldwell just continues each week.
First down and 10 at the 37-yard line. Here's a reverse. Reese Caldwell coming right and did most of that on his own. The tackle is made. The initial contact by Teddy Gaines, number 12.
When you run a reverse, you want to make the defense react. You want to take advantage of a fast defense. Watch these guys chase the play. They chase it down the line. That opens up the outside, and Teddy Gaines is the only guy able to make the play. He stayed at home and did his job, but the reverse worked because the rest of the defense chased the toss.
That's a gain of either 9 or 10, depending upon the stretch of the chain here as they measure for the first down. Make it 9. Steve Spurrier's team has not trailed at home this year. Shucks, they've lost only 4 games in the last 11 years here, and they trail Tennessee 7-0.
And their M.O. is, and he loves it, is to jump out on people, particularly at home. Get a big lead, make the opposing team play catch-up, and let the crowd be a real factor against the opposing offense. So this is not the way he normally likes to start football games.
These are amazing numbers.
Yeah.
Particularly in the first half. The margin of difference is 33, but they have overwhelmed opponents in the first and second quarters. They trail here by 7. Second and 1. Up the middle it goes, and Robert Gillespie gets the carry across the 50. We've been a little angry this week. There's been so much talk about the absence of Ernest Graham and what it'll mean, and Gillespie says, in a sense, hey, what the heck? I'm not, you know, mashed potatoes back here.
Yeah, he's a different style back, but very capable. And this graphic right here, this is what I think the key to the game is. Which front 7 can dominate and dictate the flow? It comes out in rushing defense and quarterback sacks. And as you see, Tennessee and Florida, the top 2 in the Southeastern Conference.
Second successive first down. This one is knocked down, and Grossman almost caught his own rejected pass. And Rex Grossman had to turn defender when he realized he wasn't going to be able to grab it.
One thing you got to remember, Rex Grossman is not real tall. So if you can get some penetration, and that was a sidearm throw, which made it even lower, and John Henderson, that big body in there, got his hands on the football. But Tennessee is very strong inside with Henderson and Hainsworth. If those two guys can push inside, it'll really help the Volunteers. Different look on defense. Look at all the movement by the Volunteers. New look.
Two down linemen. They stunt. They blitz. They come from everywhere, and it's knocked down again and intercepted.
Two plays in a row. John Henderson. Jefferson gets his hands on the football, and that time Jabari Greer comes away with the interception. It was a different look, a different style of defense that John Chavis hasn't shown. But watch Henderson get his hands on the football again. He's not going to get the sack. He gets the big hand up, and Jabari Greer, who was blitzing on the play, comes up with the play. Watch Henderson. He's got his eyes on the quarterback. He can't get the sack, but he can get the football. And Tennessee across the 50-yard line again.
That gives Tennessee a first down at the 47, first turnover of the ball game. Clawson comes across the middle. That one is knocked down by Ian Scott, number 99.
That was almost turnabout. Ian Scott was eyeing the goal line the other way. He's a very good athlete, a guy who, as a senior in high school, played center on the state championship basketball team here in Gainesville High School. Watch Ian Scott gets one hand on it, but just can't come up with the catch.
Second down 10, Washington and Bobby Graham break off wide right. There's big Ian Scott playing at home. Jason Witten starts in motion, the second tight end. And up the middle, nice defense on Travis Stevens. Gus Scott came in number 9 and made the initial contact.
As of late, Tennessee has really been forcing opponents to cough up the football much better, and it's been a big part of their defensive success. You see, the first 6 games, only 8 turnovers forced. The last 4 games, 12. So a real turnaround in their aggressiveness in going for the football, and certainly that one helped put them in great position now.
Volunteers lead by 7, 3rd and 9. Late stages of the first quarter of play. From the shotgun, Florida brings 4. They bring 1 from the corner. Here's Clawson, forced out by Marquand Manuel, and that will be a flag and a penalty, and that is going to give Tennessee a first down.
Yeah, that's a very dumb penalty.
Alex Brown.
No, I think Mike Mateo is the guy that's going to get the penalty. Alex was chasing him, but Mateo is the one who hit him up high, out of bounds.
After the play was over, dead ball foul on the defense, 15 yards, the first down.
It was a good defensive call by John Hope. They had him confused. They only rushed 3, and as Casey Clawson gets out of bounds, he hit him up by the head, and any official's going to call that. And a very unfortunate penalty for Florida. You got him stopped on 3rd down after the turnover, and now you turn around and give him a freebie. Kelly Washington hasn't been involved in the game yet. He's up here. Keep an eye on him.
1st and 10 at the 29. Boston again with a lot of time. Across the middle, wide open. Here's Graham inside the 10 and down at the 5-yard line. A 24-yard grab for Bobby Graham.
This is a great read by Casey Clawson. He was looking for his tight end first on the other side. He came to his secondary receiver, Bobby Graham, and right in the middle of the zone, he makes his second catch. Again, you concentrate on those outside receivers. You got to find other places to go with the football, and Bobby Graham coming through right now for Tennessee.
Casey Clawson, number 7 from Northridge, California. Philip Fulmer's choice to take over as starting quarterback midway through his freshman season last year. He did not play in this game a year ago. Here's Stevens, stuffed. Nor, for that matter, just parenthetically, did Rex Grossman. Neither quarterback who starts today played a year ago.
This is one thing that Florida has done a great job. Their offense has turned it over more this year than they did last year. 25 turnovers, but the defense has been able to play sudden change really well, only giving up 53 points off of those turnovers. They've got their back against the wall right now on 2nd down and 6.
Dante Stallworth breaks off wide right. Travis Stevens, the deep back of the eye, and that is Bobby Graham in motion. Draw play, Stevens up the middle. Touchdown, Tennessee! Florida came into this game favored by 18 points. Philip Fulmer told us yesterday, my guys are kind of angry about that.
Well, this was just excellent execution. The fullback Bartholomew Offenhauser gets a great block from the tackle spot, and Travis Stevens sneaks in behind for the touchdown.
Alex Wall is on for the extra point. On its first possession, Tennessee uses 7 minutes and 5 seconds to get a touchdown. Now they turn an interception into a TD, and they are shockingly up by 14. Except for a small section of this stadium where they are playing Rocky Top over and over and over, this swamp crowd is stunned. Smokey's happy.
And that crowd's supposedly going to be a terrific factor against Casey Clawson. A little quiet right now.
Here's Ratliff drifting back, and Alex Walls, another booming kickoff, forcing Florida to start at its own 20-yard line. The unique perspective of today's game provided courtesy of the Saturn Light Chip. Saturn's new light chip is proud to bring you these aerial views of Ben Hill Griffin Stadium and the University of Florida campus from high above Saturn. Hoping you are enjoying the game and the view. Some of our crew got to go up in the blimp on Thursday. You and I, of course, were industriously studying tape.
I was on the practice field. They waved to me. They called me. And I waved to them.
First down and 10. Here's Grossman out of the backfield. Gillespie, who is a fine pass receiver from that tailback position, is able to pick up 5. Sophomore Rex Grossman, brilliant season thus far, needs to rally his offense now as they trail by 14 points. Here comes the pressure, knocked backwards.
Third time that they've got a hand on the football, and they brought pressure. Just like Philip Fulmer said, they're going to come after Rex Grossman. Watch the pressure. Dominique Stevenson, watch all this push up front. Stevenson comes unblocked, and he's the one, actually the inside, they got the hand. It might have been Haynesworth. Watch Rex Grossman. After he throws, he hit it right on Dominique Stevenson. And he's still bothered a little bit by one of his fingers in there.
Could not tell if he hit the helmet or just a shoulder pad. Third and 6.
Here's that different look on defense again by Tennessee. Movement, trying to create confusion.
Two down, they'll bring 4. And Grossman goes deep left side. He's got a man at the 30-yard line. That will be a Florida first down. The catch is made by Richey Caldwell, his second of the first quarter.
See, Tennessee has not shown this kind of movement. Look at all these guys kind of jockeying around, all right? They're moving around. They're jumping in. They're jumping out. Even a defensive lineman right here is moving and changing positions, trying to create confusion of the blocking schemes up front.
Caldwell able to pick up a first down at the 31. Grossman has had passes knocked down 3 times, twice by John Henderson.
Yeah, and 6 pressures against him, which is exactly what Tennessee wanted to do.
He's back to throw again. Will have to scramble and is hit from behind and dropped after a gain of 1 yard at the 32-yard line. And it's big John Henderson, number 98.
This is an excellent Tennessee defense, particularly when they're healthy. As you take a look at what they've done, the one area they've struggled right there in the pass defense. They haven't had all their linemen healthy. Henderson's been hurt. Overstreet's been hurt. Andre Lott, one of their best corners, has been hurt. But I'll tell you, they're healthy now, and they're playing very well right now. They're doing exactly what they need to do. Get after Rex Grossman.
Second and 9, John Henderson, Outland Trophy winner a year ago, said this is why he came back for his senior season. Zone blitz, Grossman drills it. Taylor Jacobs to the 45. Nice. First down, Florida, a gain of 13.
Nice job by Rex. Again, the confusion is picked up, and he hangs in there. And right now, I think the key thing for Rex Grossman and Steve Spurrier is to stay patient. You know, when they lost to Auburn earlier in the year, they got a little frustrated early and got a little impatient with their play calling. This is still the best offense in the entire country, and they still are going to make a lot of big plays. They just need to settle down, protect the quarterback, and let Rex do his thing.
Zach Zadalis has moved back to the starting center spot. He snaps it back, a draw play. Gillespie bounces off the tackle, regains the line of scrimmage, plus a couple of feet. That was about it as Rashad Baker, number 16, made the tackle.
One thing that Tennessee is doing a lot more than they've done in other games, and Auburn did the same thing. They're doing a lot of stunts, a lot of twists, a lot of movement. And Auburn created some confusion and particularly were effective on stopping the run by doing that up front as well.
Officially no gain in the last play, second and 10. Final 25 seconds, opening quarter. three down linemen now. Here comes the blitz. They stunt, and they've come, and Grossman lets it go. Caught! Diving catch, Taylor Jacobs. First down at the Tennessee 41.
Nice job by Robert Gillespie getting his nose in there, picking up the blitz, and giving Grossman time to get the ball downfield. If you blitz, you're going to leave single coverage outside. Taylor Jacobs does a nice job of turning gains around, and then the nice throw by Grossman, low and away from the defender. Really, the emergence of Taylor Jacobs has been what's caused this offense to take off. I mean, when this offense has been the best over the years, it's when they've had three guys to go to with the football, and that's exactly what Grossman has now.
That's the end of our first quarter with the score 14-0 Tennessee. We return to Gainesville, Florida after this message and this word from your local station. Welcome back to the Swamp, Gainesville, Florida. Tennessee ranked fourth in the country, 9-1. A 14-0 lead as we start the second quarter. The Gators with a first and 10 of the Tennessee 41. Their first serious movement offensively of the game. Here's Grossman. Deep right side, single coverage. And the catch is made. My gracious, Breece J. Caldwell.
What a throw, though. I mean, you just cannot put the ball any other spot. Over the outside shoulder, right on the sideline. Impossible to defend. And this is good coverage by Andre Locke. He's in position. Caldwell pins him to the inside. Now watch the throw. Out over the outside, impossible to defend. And the left foot clearly in. Great throw, great concentration on the sideline by Riche.
And a quick strike from Rex Grossman, a first and goal from the one. In the red zone this year, 24 of his touchdowns. Here's the toss right. Gillespie met and driven down. Tackle is made by Keon Whiteside, number 50. Second down.
Again, this is where Ernest Graham maybe is missed. He's a more physical runner than Gillespie. He's able to break tackles a little more.
On second down, Gaffney split way out wide to the left side. Quarterback keeper, touchdown, Florida. Rex Grossman.
We've seen him do all different kinds of quarterback sneaks. We've seen him dive over with the football. We've seen him go low. This time he just kind of bounced down the line until he found a crease. This started out over the center and ended up over the tackle. Watch Rex Grossman. It's not there. It's not there. Here's a crease right outside the tackle, and the Gators on the board.
Jeff Chandler, the fifth-year senior, on for the extra point. All-time leading scorer in Florida history. He now has 355 points. Rex Grossman, 1 yard touchdown run. 14-7, Tennessee still leads.
Tennessee. You can watch games on Saturday, Sunday, Monday night, whenever you want to, and you won't find many balls thrown any better than this one by Rex Grossman to Riche Caldwell. Perfect place for the football, and the Gators on the scoreboard. Man, what a throw.
80-yard drive in 10 plays. Now Matt Petrovich, a freshman, is on for the kickoff. He is an old-fashioned straight-on kicker. Leonard Scott is the deep man for Tennessee. Here's Petrovich taken by Scott. Gathers it in at the three. Goes right. And the world-class speedster halted in his return at the 20-yard line as Philip Fulmer looks on. Well, 14-7. This has really been a game of great contrast so far.
Yeah, it really has. And Tennessee is doing what they need to do. They got the early lead. They withstood the first flurry. And they held the ball for over 9 minutes in that first quarter. That's their M.O. That's the way they want to win this game. And right now, both teams kind of getting their feel for the game.
Casey Clawson. In at quarterback, first down and 10. Witten will split off wide right.
They're not afraid to throw it to him out there.
That's where they go, Jason Witten. And he muscles his way. A fumble picked up by Todd Johnson.
That's a good call.
That ball was live.
Gus Scott forced it. Johnson picked it up.
John Hoke has told us on a number of occasions that Gus Scott is one of the best football players on this whole team. This is a mismatch. He's only 5'10", going against a much bigger Jason Witten at 6'5", 265. But watch Gus Scott strip the ball out. Rips the ball out. It's in play. And Todd Johnson right there to scoop it up. He had it in the wrong arm. You know, if you're going to protect the football, put it in the outside arm away from the defense.
First down, 10 after the turnover. Quick strike.
The pass.
Gaffney, he's got a man in the end zone and overthrows it. Gaffney 2 weeks ago completed a 40-yard pass when he took his time.
Yeah.
This time he hurried it to Carlos Perez.
He did two things. He hurried it and he didn't put any air under it. And the guy was breaking wide open. All he has to do, here's Gaffney. He's going to come off the line and Perez is going to run to the corner. All Gaffney has to do is loft it. Put a little air under it, let him run to it. But he threw it on a line, and if you do that, it has to be perfect.
Now Steve Spurrier says, we had it.
Yep.
We had it.
That was one of those ball plays he drew up this week.
Out of the gun. Here comes Tennessee stunning. Grossman with time. Incomplete. In the end zone. Teddy Gaines was covering. It was intended for Jabbar Gaffney.
Take a look. This is on the other side of the formation. And it looks like they had him outnumbered over here. The man open on the inside. Grossman reading it and going away to the backside.
And again, five wideouts, one of whom is Robert Gillespie, the tailback. On third and 10 from the 16. Gaffney, bottom of the screen. Tennessee brings five. They got a blitz. Grossman. Is thrown. Face mask. This one will go against Tennessee.
Well, they created the confusion. They got the pressure and they got him in there. The question will be, will this be a 5-yard or a 15-yard? They got what they wanted. They confused Rex Grossman and they had a man running free. It's Bernard Jackson who is going to get the pressure. Now watch, left hand on the face mask. He twists the head completely. Is it going to be 5 or 15? We've seen a crucial third down penalty go against the Gators on the late hit by Ricky Natiel. Now we get one against Tennessee.
Al Ford is our referee today. And this conference is going to go on a little bit. Now the option's being explained to Rex Grossman.
Have an incidental face mask against the defense. The 5-yard penalty from the previous spot. Repeat third down.
Bernard Jackson upset because he was in great position to get the sack. I mean, he beat his man. It was a good call by John Chavis, but he was very fortunate. 5-yard doesn't give him an automatic first down.
Third and 10 becomes third and 5 at the 11. Jacobs, Perez, Caldwell. Trips right.
Watch the back of the end zone here on this one. Guys cutting in front short and then somebody getting to the back of the end zone.
And Tennessee, two down again. See how many they bring. They'll bring five. Here's Grossman, lets it go in traffic. Gillespie to the 5. Close.
Very close. Again, I like what John Chavis is doing, though. He is not laying back. He's not playing conservative. He blitzed Grossman again. And Gillespie, instead of protecting this time, he slips out. And they go to him with the football right away. Nice hands. And that's the thing that he does best, catch the ball out of the backfield.
And that will necessitate a stretch of the chain to see if they got the first down.
Nice play by Gillespie.
They got the first down.
You know, he's not as powerful as Ernest Graham. He doesn't break tackles, but he is much more elusive. I mean, he is a guy that can make you miss, whether it's running a route or catching it outside. There's Ernest Graham.
Injured when tackled by Florida State's Darnell Dockett 2 weeks ago. A very controversial tackle. Rand Carthen is in now as a tailback on first and goal. 14-7, Tennessee leads. Carthen 2 yards. Roberts, the lead block. Get the scoop on the SEC and see where your team ranks in the Sportsline 117 power rankings. Just go to cbs.sportsline.com or AOL, keyword, CBS Sportsline. Second and goal from the 3. And again, it's Rand Carthen. Alex Brown looks on, playing his last home game at Florida Field. Play fake, Grossman into the corner. Got a man, can't get him. Led Gaffney by a touch too much.
And that was a one-man route. They kept both tight ends in the block. The back stayed in the block. It was just one-on-one going to his favorite target. No other receivers on this route except Jabbar Gaffney. And normally, Gaffney makes that catch. I mean, he is one of the most sure-handed guys you'll find in college football. Not able to corral that one.
Third and goal from the 3.
Watch the crossing routes here on third down.
Grossman back. Deep in the end zone. Tipped and incomplete. The flag is down. In the backfield.
Holding against Florida. Again, good pressure. The front 7 of Tennessee, when they need the pressure, able to get it. The 10th time in the ball game they've been able to get pressure on Rex Grossman. We've seen Rex Grossman play all year, and nobody has gotten this kind of pressure against him the way Tennessee is so far today.
Holding on the offense, the penalty is declined. Fourth down.
That draws a grimace from Steve Spurrier and brings up the field goal unit. Jeff Chandler had one extra point attempt made his freshman year of 1997, appealed to the NCAA to lose that year and be granted an extra year of eligibility. It was given, so he is a fifth-year senior. And he's now connected on 13 consecutive field goals for Florida. CBS Sports coverage of the Home Depot SEC football will continue after this word from your local station. Nighttime descending on the swamp, so named at the end of the 91 season by Steve Spurrier because he said swamps are where gators live. We feel comfortable there, and they have. They've lost only 4 times since 1990. They trail in this one, but the margin now 14-10. Here's Petrovich with the kick, and Leonard Scott drifts over. We'll let it go through the end zone. That'll be a touchback, and we'll come out to the 20-yard line. 14-10, 11:42 remaining in the first half of play. Well, you look from overhead, and we're getting very close to our own particular version of Where's Waldo time. We've been traveling a mascot. We're not the Oregon Ducks, but we have a duck who comes with us. And, oh, my gosh, look at this. It is time.
He did it for me.
Oh, the duck is stealing your thunder.
He's taking over my gig.
He's a Saturn blimp duck. Guys everywhere. Here's Clawson out of the backfield, incomplete. It'll be second down and 10. And so, Mr. Blackledge, it is now time for that much-anticipated question of the night. The last time Tennessee defeated Florida in Gainesville, 1971. We've told you Philip Fulmer was an offensive guard for the Volunteers. Here's the question. Who were the 2 coaches in that game? Give you some time to think about it.
Affleck.
All right, show off.
Second and 10. Ducks up. Clawson across the middle, caught at the 25-yard line. That's John Finlayson's 2nd catch of the game. That equals his number in the previous 10 games.
I'll tell you one thing that's happening right now is that Reggie Coleman, the left tackle, 6'5", 315 senior, is doing a very nice job on Alex Brown. He's neutralized him. He's getting his hands on him. He's not allowing Alex Brown to be a factor in this football game so far. Let's see what he does on this third down play.
3rd and 5. Goes across the middle. It is caught. And that is a Tennessee first down Jason Witten with the grab. He hangs on to this one. And Tennessee moves the ball.
This is a nice job. First, they put Witten on Alex Brown's side, and that enabled Coleman to get on the block. And then they brought him on the crossing route. And you see how athletic he is. He's 6'5", 265 pounds, but he's able to run away from Todd Johnson and make the play. Here's Coleman on the outside. Gets his hands, his feet in good position, and the ball's gone.
First and 10 with a four-point lead. Tennessee at their own 35. Now Witten splits off wide right against Leto Shepard.
John Hope wanted a timeout, and Kewan Ratliff able to see the coach and make the call. Didn't like what he saw.
John Hope in his third year as defensive coordinator of the Florida Gators. Timeout, Gators, they trail by four. Welcome back to Gainesville. Tennessee up by four. They've got a first down and 10. Twin receivers wide left. The tight end Witten split off bottom of the screen wide right. Here's Casey Clawson, deep left side. Man coverage, Dante Stallworth. Incidental bumping at the 35-yard line. Benny Alexander defending and doing a nice job. And it's now time for our SEC moment presented by Sonic. The last time the Tennessee won here in Gainesville was in 1971. The Balls racked up 352 yards of total offense. The game tied 13-all in the third quarter when Tennessee quarterback Phil Pierce found Stan Trott for a 20-yard pass, capping a 99-and-a-half-yard drive. The Balls went on to win it 20-13. Here's a quick pass out to Graham, wide to the left, and he gets to the 41-yard line.
And Florida is very lucky. Now, there's a flag down. Tennessee tried to quick snap him. Florida was not ready. They were not lined up, and Tennessee tried to get a quick snap. And this was very close to being a big play. Look at all this. They're not ready. They're getting lined up. They're running guys off the field. They had too many on the field. And Casey Clawson alertly had the ball snapped. Now, if he doesn't trip, Bobby Graham goes for big yardage there. I just like what Randy Sanders is doing and how Casey Clawson is executing. He's managing the offense. They're attacking.
A substitution in violation against the defense. 5-yard penalty, repeat, second down.
I mean, he is managing the game, and Randy is not playing conservative. You know, everybody expected him to maybe come out and establish the run and then throw, but they've come out attacking with their passing game early, and they're not getting the ball necessarily to Stallworth and Washington yet. It's been other guys, the tight end and Bobby Graham.
And Casey Clawson, an impressive 9 of 13, second and 5 from the 40. And time called by the line judge. Got very quiet all of a sudden. And now we go back to that 1971 game. I asked Philip Fulmer if he remembered anything significant about it. He said only that we went 99.5 yards. He was a starting right guard. That team went on and won 10 games and lost 2 that season. They had a very, very good year. Philip Fulmer. Well, play is going to start again with no walk-off of any kind. Second down and 5. Stevens jolted as he gets to the 41-yard line by Andre Davis.
You're talking about Philip Fulmer, and I think one of the things that's very obvious right now is that they are playing and coaching very loose. And that's not always been the case in the Tennessee-Florida game, but I really think the fact that they did not have an open week before this game, the first time since 1995 they didn't have an open week, and that was just an extra week to not get caught up in the hype of this game. It was business as usual after the Vanderbilt game, and I think they're playing and coaching much looser than they have in the past.
Tennessee looks at 3rd and 4 now, and Clawson will go out of the shotgun. Scott Will snaps it back, corner blitz. He comes right, and it's bobbled and intercepted. Picked off, and here goes Mike Nateel. It went right through the hands of Jason Witten. Nateel grabbed it at his knees and counter punches inside the 10.
And 2 times they put Witten out in the flank and thrown it to him, and both times it's resulted in a turnover. The first time Gus Scott stripped him, this time he just doesn't make the catch. Watch Witten. He runs a nice route. He's there. He's open. The ball is thrown perfectly, but he lets it get into his shoulder pads. He doesn't catch it with his hands, and that bounces out, and another turnover for the Florida Gators. The Phillips said, hey, we need you. You're off to a good start. Don't get down because we need you in this football game.
After the second Tennessee turnover, Grossman wants to strike on first down. A lot of time. Deep. Got touchdown. Jabbar Gaffney.
Pressuring Rex Grossman, but not on that play. You cannot give Rex Grossman this much time to throw. Watch the pocket. Nothing around Rex Grossman. He waits until he sees Gaffney appear in his sights.
27th touchdown for the sophomore from Jacksonville. That's in his career. It's Grossman to Gaffney. It's become a deadly combination for Florida. Grossman to Gaffney took 9 seconds for 21 yards after the Mike Mateel interception. Two turnovers. Well, late in the game, Todd and I, along with Joe's help, will be selecting the Army Most Valuable Player of the Game, and Gaffney will be a candidate, no doubt. Usually is when the Gators play. Here's Petrovich with the kick. This one very high, but also very short, and it's taken. A fair catch call at the 19-yard line.
Back to the touchdown. It was a double post, and I've got to believe there was a bust in the coverage because it's a double post. Now watch, three guys are going to go to Caldwell and only one on Gaffney. I think right here Julian Battle needs to go over the top and help the other receiver, but there were three defenders on Caldwell, only one on Gaffney. That's not good math on defense.
13th touchdown of this season for Jabbar Gaffney. First and 10. Twin receivers wide left, and Jason Witten goes in tight to the right now. Travis Stevens up the middle, big hole. Cuts left, it's a foot race. And Stevens across the 50. The angle is there from Todd Johnson, but an enormous gain for the 5'9", 190-pound back.
What a response. What a response by Tennessee. Jason Witten started this play out on the flank. Then he moves in to block. Watch the blocking as they cave in the backside. Travis Stevens just able to slip in there. Excellent blocking. Nobody on Florida getting off their blocks. And Travis Stevens shows you why he's one of the finalists for the Doak Walker Award. When they need a play, he comes through.
A 49-yard gain and a first down at the 32-yard line. Hand off Joy Fleming. This time Florida set for it.
What Tennessee hopes to do is be successful enough running the football with Travis Stevens that Florida has to bring an extra safety up to defend the run. If they do that, that means man-to-man matchups outside on Dante Stallworth and Kelly Washington. So far, Florida hasn't had to resort to that. But a couple more runs like that one by Travis, and they'll get the matchups they want outside.
No gain for Fleming. Second down and 10. Stevens is back in the backfield. And again, Witten split off wide right. Clawson across the middle has a receiver at the 26-yard line. Bobby Graham again, number 11. That's where he makes a living, is across the middle. Well, it is time now for the answer to the
Aflac
question. Last time Tennessee defeated Florida, who were the two coaches? And the answers, Bill Battle for Tennessee, who had taken over as the youngest head coach in the country at the age of 28 in 1969, and Doug Dickey, who, of course, is now the distinguished athletic director at Tennessee. Third and 5.
A lot of time in the huddle that time by Tennessee. They're down to 9 seconds on the play clock.
Comes a backside blitz. Witten, man coverage for the tight end. And can't hang on as Gus Scott, who seems to have drawn responsibility for Jason Witten, is there with him.
I love it, though. You know, go right back to the guy. He's had two turnovers. He's a young guy. He's a sophomore. Go right back to him. And Gus Scott didn't touch the ball, but got his hand in the face, in the eyes of Jason Witten. Lawson thought he had a big one there, but nice position by Gus Scott. But I like going right back to him. You know, don't let that guy get out of the game.
Now the field goal attempt from Alex Walls of 43 yards out. He's 13 of 17 for the season. No!
Well, he had started the season 6 of 9. He's made his last 7, so he's been on a little bit of a hot streak. Looked like he had to stutter step a little bit before the kick. Looked like the timing was off a little bit, and he just pulls it left.
Might have seen the presence of number 13, Alex Brown. Brown has 3 blocks so far this season, 2 in one game.
Now's when the Tennessee defense has to really step up and respond.
Grossman will hand it off. This is Gillespie, number 20, after the 31-yard line. And time now for our Exxon and Mobil virtual playbook.
Well, even though Ernest Graham is hurt, Florida is still going to run the football, and their favorite play to run is just a simple zone play, whether it's Gillespie or Graham, and it's zone blocking, which means the linemen block areas rather than individual people. They hand the ball off deep and let him use his vision, and a lot of times they run behind Mike Pearson, their best offensive lineman, the All-American left tackle.
Second down and 6. Here's Grossman back. Fires it right side, caught by Gillespie, one-on-one out on the corner. Rashad Baker is there defensively for Tennessee, number 16. Graham and Gillespie. Graham, the starter, he is the only back that's been over 100 yards this year. And for the season, you see the difference, 650 to 374. Ernest Graham, a much more powerful runner, point that Todd has made.
And Gillespie the better receiver. I mean, you saw their total yards just about the same.
Third and 1. Florida up. Quarterback sneak again. Grossman coming left and appears to have gotten enough to earn the first down. Will Overstreit, number 90, is there. And it is good for a first down. Florida. Well, winner of this game goes into the SEC championship game, and we'll have it for you next Saturday night, 8 o'clock Eastern time from Atlanta. Winner of this game takes on either LSU or Auburn. They meet later this evening in Baton Rouge. First down and 10. Grossman out of the shotgun. Here's Stunning. The flip out of the backfield to Gillespie. This is where he excels. Out to the 48-yard line before Eddie Moore, number 37, makes the stop.
Yeah, nice call by Steve Spurrier. This is what you do with a guy who's shifty and elusive. It's just like a running play. You give him the ball out in space, and you let him do his thing, which is make people miss. Sticks his foot in the ground, cuts back in, cuts back out. And for Gillespie now, 4 catches for 29 yards.
On second down and 1, Caldwell breaks off wide to the right side. Here's Grossman with play action. Blitz coming. He gets rid of it. Comes near side. Gaffney out of bounds at the 40-yard line. The quick release of Rex Grossman. A gain of 13.
One of the things that you feel right now in the ballgame is that the offensive line of Florida has kind of taken the cue to step up their game a little bit. They're not allowing their quarterback to get pressured as much. Here's the end of the play. Right there, the right foot out of bounds. A moan from the crowd, but I think a good call by our crew here.
Take a look at it from the end zone.
Yeah. Yep. Toes. Tippy toes.
A little tap dance. A minor league Baryshnikov. Or Gregory Hines, I guess. Here's the pass thrown out of bounds. Off balance throw by Rex Grossman. Well, let's get you up to date on what's going on around the SEC today. Ole Miss comes from behind and defeats Vanderbilt. Georgia knocks off Houston 35-7. Kentucky loses to Indiana 26-15 tonight. Big game in Baton Rouge, LSU and Auburn. And BYU goes in to take on Mississippi State in Starkville.
And Alabama won on Thursday in Birmingham over Southern Miss in a torrential downpour.
17-14, 4:23 to go before the break, and a second down, 10, Florida. They've scored 17 unanswered. Motion left side. That's the tight end, Ben Troop.
Yeah, and again, Tennessee.
5 yards, still second down.
Tennessee trying to give a little bit of that different look. They've got two down linemen and then a bunch of other people standing up and moving in and out of gaps. See, they got two guys down right here, and everybody else is just kind of moving around, in and out, back and forth, up and down, and Ben Troop just moved early. It's not a look that they've shown at all on film, and you got to credit John Chavis for getting something new like that in on a regular work week without the extra days.
That gives Florida second and 15 from the 45, nursing a three-point lead. Now three down, and here comes six. Grossman, he's going to be hit as he lets it go, and it's incomplete. Flag. This one might be called on number 14, Julian Battle. I think that is what he is acknowledging. It was a bad battle plan.
What Tennessee is trying to do with this different look and this different movement is they're trying to overload one side. It's not a complete blitz with all man-to-man. It's try to get four rushers to one side and get one more guys than you can block. Watch Julian Battle at the end of this play. A little contact, a push from behind. And Julian Battle, that's a little tough for him. He's a strong safety, kind of playing underneath coverage like a cornerback would on Taylor Jacobs. And a little shaken up at the end of the play.
And after the penalty, a first down 10, Florida at the Tennessee 30-yard line.
Stephen Marsh, number 9, the new guy in for Tennessee.
Here's a four-man volunteer rush. The pass complete to Gillespie at the 25, hit from behind at the 23. And there is a flag on the near side of the field at the 32-yard line. And while we await on the interpretation, let's check in with Jill Arrington.
Well, Vern, these two teams met here in 1997. Now behind a stingy, blitzing pressure defense. The Gators, they recorded three sacks and numerous knockdowns on Tennessee's quarterback, Peyton Manning. But with a 7-0 first quarter lead, Florida's strong safety, Tony George, intercepts a Manning pass and raced 89 yards for a touchdown. The Gators never looked back and cruised 33-20. Peyton Manning, he never defeats the Gators. He was 0-4.
All right, Jill, thank you. Six men on the line cost the Gators 5 yards, so they now operate with a first and 15 from the 35. And Grossman lets it go. Taylor Jacobs at the 31-yard line. Boy, they're coming from every conceivable direction that Reggie Grossman.
And again, John Chavis, it's a guessing game. He's trying to overload one side. He's still playing with a safety. It's not like complete man-to-man coverage. Here's Chief John Chavis right there. But it's a guessing game. And that time he guessed right. He overloaded to Grossman's left, and a guy was able to get in his face and force the underneath throw.
Second down, 11, 3, 10 to go before the break. Twin sets. Wide right. And here comes a rush of six. They got him as he let it go. And Grossman's going to get up slowly.
Nice couple plays by the Tennessee defense. Again, we made the point. They had lost that edge in getting pressure, but they picked it up here the last couple plays. Watch again. They're standing up. They're moving around, trying to create confusion. And they bring more than they can block. And a nice job by Eddie Moore putting a lick on the quarterback. You want to get to him, and you want to hit him as often as you possibly can, because those hits add up during the course of a game.
2 minutes, 54 seconds to go before halftime, and Florida uses its second timeout. 2:54 before the break, and at the half, we'll go back to New York. Tim Brando and Spencer Tillman with scores and highlights. On this big day of college football, it's 3rd and 11 here.
I think John Henderson needs to step up and make a play for Tennessee. This may be the biggest play of the game for the Volunteers.
Grossman with time, goes left side. Jacobs has it, and he is down with it. First down at the 15-yard line, a 16-yard gain.
Well, true to form, they are going after Rex Grossman. They're not sitting around waiting. They're not playing passive. But Rex stays in there. I mean, that's guts by a quarterback to hang in there knowing you're going to get hit and making the throw downfield. Hang in there as long as you can. He got hit harder by his own guy Ben Troop put a better lick on him than the Tennessee guy.
After a slow start, that is the 14th completion of the first half for Grossman.
The reason that play was so important, as good as Tennessee has played in this first half, they can't afford to go down 10 to end the first half.
Play clock.
Nope, didn't get it.
Gonna cost them five. I don't think Steve is saying it's my fault. So that'll be a delay of game call.
The 25-second clock expired. 5 yard penalty, still first down.
Here's Grossman a moment ago.
Yeah. Gets up a little slow. The ref comes. He didn't start the countdown. Wants to make sure he's okay, though. A little hobble. A little shake of the head.
And recall that he hit his throwing fingers on a helmet or a shoulder pad back in the first quarter. First down and 15. Grossman scrambles. Cuts back to his right. Throws it underhand. Are you kidding me? Kelvin Kite was KO'd after he caught the pass, and an underhand throw from a falling Rex Grossman.
Well, this is just instinct. I mean, you don't coach this, you don't teach this. Grossman thinks he's going to have a spot open. As he's falling down, he just instinctively finds a blue shirt. But Kelvin Kite is laid out by Eddie Moore. I mean, a good play by Rex Grossman to get something, but Kelvin Kite defenseless in this position from the hit from Eddie Moore.
Wow. Kelvin Kite still down at the 15-yard line as Eddie Moore had a clean but unexpected shot at him. He did hold on to that underhanded toss from Rex Grossman.
I think Tennessee has achieved one of their goals in this game. If Florida could have had their druthers, they would have wanted this to be a track meet. And Tennessee wants it to be like a 15-round heavyweight fight. They want it to be a physical game. And they've got it into being a physical game. But they need a big stop right here. Take another look at the end of this play. Rex Grossman, good coverage downfield. And then after he realizes he can't scramble, the heads-up play, but a head-back hit. Wow.
That looked on the replay like helmet to helmet. Second down and 7 at the 12. Triple receivers to the right. Here's a quick toss out to the right. Riche Caldwell looks for a block from Taylor Jacobs, and that was a kind of a puny effort.
Great play by Andre Lott, though. Great play.
On Sunday, CBS and the Jim Henson Company present a television event of gigantic proportions. Matthew Modine leads an all-star cast in Jack and the Beanstalk, The Real Story. It's a modern-day twist on a classic tale. That's Sunday on CBS. Kelvin Kite on the bench, 3rd and 6 on the field. 17-14 on the scoreboard, less than a minute to play, first half. Gillespie, nothing there. It'll be fourth down, and we're going to see Jeff Chandler again. And Jill, what's the update on Kelvin Kite?
Well, you guys saw him get nailed on that play. He does have a concussion. He's a little out of it. They're checking him close. They'll take him in the locker room and check on him more in the half.
That was a huge stop by Tennessee, but I'm not sure Florida's ready to go for a field goal unless they're just letting the clock run down. I think Steve may go for this on fourth down. I was a little surprised by that call. He maybe thought Gillespie was going to sneak in there. Now he's just going to let the clock go down, and then he'll probably kick it.
Clock at 8 seconds with 4th and 5 forthcoming. That the final timeout for the Gators. They're up by 3. We'll try to go up by 6. And we will have the SEC championship game for you 1 week from tonight in Atlanta. Winner of this against either LSU or Auburn. Now the senior Jeff Chandler, attempting his 14th consecutive field goal. It is up. And it is good. Chandler down. They are popping everybody.
I tell you what, I thought Will Overstreet was going to block this field goal. He got in there so quick, and that's who hit Chandler. Watch Overstreet right up the middle. I don't know how he missed it. Oh, what a stop. Yep, what a stop by the Tennessee defense. Six is better than 10.
A benign Gator, anything but brutal. 20 unanswered now for the Gators. And Jeff Chandler will kick off this time. He and Petrovich alternate. I'm not sure what dictates which man will kick. But it's going to be Chandler now kicking to Leonard Scott. Now Scribbin. This one taken by Corey Larkins, number 23. He's a running back turned defensive back. He hasn't played much on offense. Well, 14 points to start this game for Philip Fulmer and the Volunteers, but 20 unanswered now by the Florida Gators to give them a six-point edge. They got there, helped in no small measure by two turnovers, one a fumble and the other a deflection for an interception. Now here's Joe with Steve Spurrier.
Coach Spurrier, Tennessee got up on you early, but you managed to fight back through the turnovers. Is your offense in their usual rhythm yet?
Well, we haven't run very well. Of course, we hadn't tried a lot. But we hadn't scored down there, but we're fortunate to be ahead right now after the start. So we're playing decently.
All right, Coach, thank you.
Jill, thank you. 20-14, Florida at the half. We go back to our New York studios and Tim Brennan. Tennessee Volunteer football team, Leonard Scott. Back to return the kickoff of Matt Petrovich. This one again short, taken by Scott, who fumbles it, picks it up, and is hammered at the 20-yard line. Petrovich, the freshman kickoff man, 20-14 as we get start with the third quarter. How do you see each team having to react here?
Well, I think Florida has to run the ball a little bit better in the second half to take some pressure off Rex Grossman. Tennessee, I don't think they can win the game unless Kelly Washington and Dante Stallworth become factors in this second half. Stallworth had one catch, Washington zero catches in the first half, and I really think they need to score at least a field goal on this opening possession of the third quarter.
Well, you heard Philip Fulmer tell Jill Arrington, first 5 minutes are key. Here's Clawson deep. Right side behind the intended receiver, and it is incomplete. Intended for Kelly Washington, first time they've gone there tonight. At the half, the statistical breakdown fairly even, but yeah. Turnovers. Huh?
Yeah, and Tennessee very fortunate to be down only six with those two turnovers. Florida only able to capitalize for 10 points.
Second and 10. Travis Stevens and Will Bartholomew in the backfield. Here's Clawson across the middle, pattern underneath. And that is the fifth catch for Bobby Graham, who is their possession receiver in the middle of the field. They pick up 6 yards and move it out to the 26-yard line. Now turnovers 2 and 1, and this is the Tennessee team that does not turn it over much. Since 1990, look at the turnover factor in these games.
Yeah, a clear difference in the team that wins the game and the team that loses the game in those two categories, running the football and turning it over.
Third and 4. Clawson, right side, Dante Stallworth underneath on the crossing pattern across the 50. And a big first down for Tennessee at the 48.
They come out, they throw it 3 times. The first 2 times to Washington, the 3rd time to Stallworth. They got to get those guys in the game because they are the playmakers for the Tennessee offense. Stallworth had an 18-yard reception early in the game and then was silent the rest of the half. But he is a big play guy for the Tennessee offense.
Broken wrist suffered against Syracuse. He was out for 3, would not have played had this game been played on September 15th. Here's Clawson. Here's Washington. Here's a first down at the 35. What did you do? Go to the locker room at the half?
I didn't, but it just makes sense. I mean, they did everything else in that first half, and it just set up for these guys to get involved in the game because they're the two best playmakers you have, and you can't let them be shut out in this ball game.
That's Kelly Washington's first. He came on when Stallworth was out. Had an enormous game against LSU when he caught 11 for 236. He's got 55 on the season now. First and 10 at the 35. Stevens, big hole. breaks the tackle of Marquand Manuel. He is gone. Touchdown, Tennessee.
Throw, loosen him up, and then bludgeon him with the run. Now, Marquand Manuel is going to come up here and be unblocked. If you bring a safety up, he better make the play. He's unblocked. He cannot make the tackle right there on Travis Stevens, and the Gators pay for it by giving up the touchdown.
That's a 35-yard run for Travis Stevens, 110 yards on 12 carries, and the Volunteers erupt out of the halftime locker room. Travis Stevens, a finalist for the Doak Walker Award. And the Volunteers are up 21-20. Not all that far down here from Knoxville. 21-20. Ball fans loving this one as they try to win here for the first time in 30 years. Here's the kick, and it will be taken by Ratliff at the 8-yard line. Heads right, avoids the first tackle, and is down. Good downfield coverage as Florida gets it back. Well, Travis Stevens came off the bench in the championship game in 98, gained 60 yards as Tennessee defeated Florida. He didn't play in the first game of 99, saw his future as that of a backup to Jamal Lewis, Travis Henry. He asked for a redshirt year, and during that year in 1999, his father, Leonard, Sergeant Major, retired in the Army, battled colon cancer most of the year, ultimately died in the spring of 2000. Travis Henry was the starter last year. Travis Stevens waited his turn, and now as a fifth-year senior has been a marvelous springboard for the success of the Volunteers. Here's a handoff to Rand Carthen across the 22 and out to the 23-yard line. Got some pretty pictures being taken from overhead, and those pictures are being given to you courtesy of the Saturn blimp.
I wonder if they're letting our duck do the camera up there.
I think the duck might be operating the camera. Second down and six.
Look at that, the rushing yards. Last year, the only year since 90, the team that rushed for the most didn't win.
Here's Gillespie out of the backfield. First down, Florida at the 35. Tackle made by Julian Battle, a gain of 13.
Nice job of utilizing what he does best, and that is make people miss in the open field. It's an easy throw for the quarterback, and you put your guy, Gillespie, in a position to be successful. You see only 9 yards running the football, but he's able to do some things when he catches it out of the backfield.
12 minutes to go, third quarter. Tennessee moves smartly downfield. A 35-yard run from Travis Stevens to give them the lead. And a first down 10 now for Grossman and the Gators. Grossman chased right. Finds his tight end, Aaron Walker, who was popped and down by John Henderson or Rashad Moore. It was 58.
Well, it was good pressure by Rashad Moore right up the middle. That forced Grossman out of there. And did a nice job of running to the tight end for the tackle. But it was Rashad Moore with the pressure inside that forced that play to be not very effective. Again, Tennessee has not gotten a sack on Rex Grossman tonight, but they have pressured him. Look at that, 18 times they've been able to get in his face.
Second down. There's a good block. There's pressure from the backside, and Gillespie makes the grab. What a wonderful play by Grossman.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Backing up, a guy unblocked, barreling down on him, and still the poise and the presence to find Gillespie. Now watch, here's going to be a guy come unblocked. Right there, nobody assigned to him, and Grossman just has to back up enough to give himself clarity. Jabari Greer was the guy who came unblocked, and Grossman able to back up just enough to make the throw.
214 for the night thus far for Grossman, who had a string of 9 consecutive games of 300 yards plus, end by 10 yards in the victory over Florida State. Here's the attempted run up the middle, and Rand Carthen runs to the 46-yard line. Rashad Moore with a tackle.
The toughest run that the Florida Gators have had tonight. Now that's the kind of run that Ernest Graham used to give this offense. Running hard, keeping low to the ground, and breaking tackles.
Rand Carthen a lot bigger than Robert Gillespie to see him run right out of the tackle of Rashad Moore for a good game.
You know, when you have a running back named Rand, it leads to all kinds of grammatical
lessons. That makes sense, doesn't
it? Yeah. A lot of possibilities there. Here's Carthen rolling inside the 40 to the 38. Dominic Stevenson with the tackle, number 28. Eddie Moore was there to help. Well, this is as close to a playoffs as we can give you right now. Tennessee and Florida meeting here later tonight. Auburn, LSU, the winners of those respective games. We'll meet for the SEC Championship in Atlanta next Saturday night. We'll be there.
I guarantee you the Tigers will win tonight.
Ooh, that's strong. But what are my options?
I know that. I was just thinking.
Well, you know, they got the War Eagle thing, too, so sometimes it can be confusing. First sack. Bernard Jackson. They've got some fresh guys moving in and out of there. And I really like that John Chavis is continuing to go after Rex Grossman. They didn't get a sack. There's Chief again. They didn't get a sack the first half. They get their first one. Here he is. Watch him beat him to the outside. Just a good move on Max Starks. Gets outside of him and gets the first sack on Rex Grossman.
Bernard Jackson's first sack of the season for the senior, and it's second down and 15. Standard four-man front now for the Volunteers, but they're blitzing and bringing six, and here underneath is Gaffney. Got a bunch back. He's down at the 33-yard line. That's a gain of 10. It'll be a need of 5 for the first down. Midway, third quarter.
That's why I say it's a guessing game. When you try to overload and run zone blitzes, if you guess to the right side, you get a sack a lot, or at least a pressure. If you guess to the wrong side, which they did that time, you get beat. And that time, Rex Grossman able to make the completion away from the blitz.
Third and 5. Grossman, empty backfield. Steps up, drills it, tip, almost picked off. Jabari Greer tipped it, Eddie Moore almost had it.
See Grossman, not a lot of openings downfield, good coverage. Greer had it first. Wow, could have been a big turnover for the Volunteers.
And it would appear that Florida's going to go for it on fourth down.
This might be a little bit out of Jeff Chandler's range. And you know what? John Henderson, I think, needs to make a play. I like the confusion that John Chavis is creating, but I don't like that John Henderson is the guy standing up and moving around. Here he is right here. He needs to get in his stance and come off the football. That's when he's most powerful.
Fourth and 5. They will eschew the field goal. Grossman with time. Puts it on a roof and finds Taylor Jacobs. And again, pressure on Grossman, and he delivers big time.
You know, there's so much to like about Rex Grossman, but his toughness a lot of times is overlooked. As you watch the route to develop, all three receivers breaking inside and behind the linebackers, a perfect throw by Rex Grossman. But his toughness is overlooked. He hits hit, he hangs in there to the last minute, and he delivers the strike.
Here's the slip. Rashad Caldwell, second carry of the night. Good job defensively by Constantine Ritzman, and the backup defensive end makes the tackle.
Tennessee is trying to take a shot on Rex Grossman anytime they can. Legal. I mean, anytime they can knock him down on the ground, get some dirt on his uniform, get some grass up in his face mask, that's what they want to do.
And have done.
And they have done. They've done a very nice job of that, but he hangs in there. The kid is a tough, tough kid.
Second down and 7. Gators trail the Volunteers by 1. Third quarter of play. Here come 5 defensive players. Grossman dances up. Sacked for the second time in this series.
Grossman out of here.
And that will bring up third and long. Ball will be spotted just inside the 19-yard line. Alex Brown playing his final game, one of 17 in the Swamp for the last time tonight. They've been marvelous so far this year inside the red zone, and one of three tonight. Third and 13, Grossman back alone behind his center. Sedala snaps it back. Grossman into the end zone, incomplete. Richey Caldwell raises his arms and said, where were you going?
Well, they overloaded again, but this time it was well picked up by Florida. Nobody in Rex Grossman's face this time, but a little miscommunication. He's going to go to Caldwell, but this ball not thrown like a normal Rex Grossman throw. You see, it was outside, and I don't know if Rex thought Richey was going to the outside more or what, but that was not a good communication by those two.
Fifth-year senior Jeff Chandler, 2 of 2 tonight. This from 35 to reclaim the lead for the Florida Gators. Oh, he just does get it inside the left upright. He had a bit of a slump in the midseason. Missed two against Mississippi State. Came back and had problems against LSU. Decided to grow a beard.
He made that one by the hair of his chinny chin chin.
5:54 to go in the third. And Florida, having reclaimed the lead, sends Matt Petrovich out to kick off. Leonard Scott deep for Tennessee. And again, it's short, high. Scott comes up. This one will be taken on the left side by Corey Larkins. And Larkins out to the 30-yard line, from which point Tennessee takes over. Let's go down and check in with Jill Erickson.
Well, Vern, these two teams met here in 1999, and Gator quarterback Doug Johnson, he was 21 for 44, 343 yards and 3 touchdowns, but Alex Brown stole the show. Brown recorded 5 sacks, an interception, and a forced fumble. The Gators stopped Tennessee running back Jamal Lewis on 4th and 3 with 2 minutes 10 seconds left to clinch the game. The Gators defeated the Vols 23-21, and Vern, that's the score so far tonight.
Indeed it is, Jill, and it's a first down 10 Tennessee. Clawson will throw. Nope, he'll run. He's not known as a scrambler, but he slides safely in at the 35-yard line. Casey Clawson, younger brother, is a redshirt quarterback at LSU. They play later this evening at home against Auburn. And Jim and Kathy Clawson have made the trip. We were talking with Casey yesterday how they decide which game to attend, here or Baton Rouge. He said the parents come where the guy's going to play.
Absolutely. Rick's just waving a towel, cheering, wearing a baseball cap. Casey's actually slinging it in there.
2nd and 5. And again, he's forced to scramble, pulls up, comes back right, dumps it. Travis Stevens, who was hit and dropped. Marcus Akendo Johnson, well, not known as a runner, but he's been adept with the bootleg more than a couple of times this year.
Quarterback draws when they need it. When you have a guy that you're not expecting to run, sometimes the trickery is the best thing you can call. Some naked bootlegs when everybody expecting someone else to carry the ball. And in some clutch situations, Casey Clawson has come through. Now, he looks a little bit like Crazy Legs Hirsch running. But he gets the knees up high when he runs.
3rd and 1. Backs in the eye. This is Stevens darting to the outside, picks up the first down at the 47-yard line. Alex Brown makes the tackle, number 13.
It's the left side. I mean, that's where Tennessee wants to run, behind Fred Weary, their left guard, and Reggie Coleman, who is really having a nice ball game against Alex Brown tonight. Jill was talking about the night that Alex Brown had 2 years ago. And tonight, Reggie Coleman is really doing a nice job on him in both the running and the passing game.
1st and 10, Tennessee. There's Clawson back deep down the middle for Stallworth. Intercepted. Picked off by Lee Joe Shepherd. Only his 2nd of the season. He earned All-American honors a year ago when he intercepted 7.
Not really a bad decision of where to go with the ball by Clawson, but when you throw in the middle, you better not loft the ball. You better put a little more zip on it, and Leto Shepherd able to come underneath the throw, an underthrown ball, and make the interception. It's okay to throw in the middle, but you better not hang it when you throw it down there.
Had an enormously successful sophomore season statistically, not as impressive in 2001, but a big one here, and the third Tennessee turnover of the ball game.
And be prepared for Florida to go deep right away.
Here comes the corner blitz, Jabari Greer. Grossman finds Walker, the tight end. Well, it was a year ago in Knoxville. That game was played in September, the 16th of September, when Lito Shepard was back to defend A.J. Suggs, the quarterback then, and Shepard picked it off and strolled in for a touchdown from 19 out.
And Tennessee had dominated the game. They were winning 12-7 at halftime because they had to kick four field goals, and that one play put Florida in the lead.
See, the plus seven ratio for turnovers coming into this game, minus two tonight. Now here's Grossman again being pressured. Watch out.
That's a forward.
Are they calling that incomplete? I thought sure it was a lateral, Todd.
It sure looked like he threw it behind him. I mean, he was trying to get rid of it.
Bernard Jackson again.
Now take a look at this now. When Grossman rolls out, again, it's the pressure. Great pressure by Tennessee. Now watch when he throws it. He's at the... Wow,
at the 30.
That's a fumble. I mean, that is a lateral unless somebody hit it. The only thing it could be, he's dropping back. He's on this yard line.
Wow. Third and nine. Grossman. Gaffney. First down again. A gain of 17 on a third and nine play.
Down and distance doesn't affect Florida like a lot of other teams. You know, third and nine, you think you got them right where you want them, but not Florida. Their receivers are too good. And if you don't get to the quarterback, he's going to make completions, whether it's third and nine, third and 12. Their guys are just too hard to cover if you can't knock the quarterback out of his rhythm.
5 for 70. You saw that stat on Gaffney. He's got 65 for the year. And a first down 10 with a two-point lead. Here's a fake reverse. Gillespie tries to get out of jail and manages only the 39-yard line. Let's go back two plays ago and see if the ball was tipped.
Yeah, that would be the only thing that would rule it. I don't know. It didn't look tipped to me when it was thrown, and it looked like it ended up backwards.
That's either a fumble or a lateral.
That ball was behind it.
I think that view, to me, makes it look like a fumble. Second and nine. Three down linemen for Tennessee. They'll bring five again. Quick flip, left side. In and out of the hands of Rishe Caldwell. Third and nine. Again, we'll look at this. Aborted play three plays ago.
Well, Bernard Jackson is going to get the pressure, and he's going to put the hit on. Now, he hit his arm, but I don't think he hit the football. He did hit the throwing elbow, but he didn't touch the football. Now, Andre Lott hit the football. Oh, well. You know what? It doesn't matter. They called it an incomplete. And it's another third and long for the Florida offense.
Last time they had third and nine, they gained 17. Here's Grossman, takes the snap under center, finds Gillespie out of the backfield again. Close. They'll spot the ball just outside the 31. Don't know if he got enough.
Now, this is really a good call by Steve Spurrier, because Tennessee is blitzing, but Gillespie is going to act like he's blocking and then just drop into the pattern. You expect him to block the blitz, but he goes right by him, and Grossman drops the football to him. Jabbar Gaffney says, hey, I could have scored a touchdown. I mean, Gillespie got as close to the first down, but I would have got a six.
Florida faces a fourth and one. They'll chat during the call timeout. Welcome back to the Swamp, where Rex Grossman has, in the process of leading his team to a lead, become the all-time single-season leader passing yardage. It's fourth and one.
The quarterback sneaked here a couple times already.
Right guard.
Yep.
Tommy Moody, the senior number 72, who regained a starting spot tonight, having backed up Zach Zadalis in that spot for the last 4 weeks.
Well, whatever the play call was, it just changed, because fourth and one and fourth and six are much different. There you see Moody. It looked like Grossman was trying to go in a hard count to draw Tennessee offside. Rand Carthen also got fooled by the snap count. almost assuredly a pass.
Florida goes for the first down from the Tennessee 36. Fourth and six.
Gaffney's got single at the bottom.
Here's Grossman. Good block with time. Now caught and dropped and a flag is thrown.
That's going to be holding on Florida, and Tennessee comes through again.
Will Overstreet, who suffered a severe ankle sprain in the victory over LSU, was out for 4 weeks. A big, big play.
Well, they get the sack, but Rex Grossman had enough time to make a throw. Credit the coverage downfield by the Tennessee secondary. Watch this play unfold. Now, Overstreet's here. He's going to get the sack, but watch as this play unfolds, the coverage downfield. Nobody open for Florida. They've got Gaffney doubled, and Rex Grossman nowhere to go.
On downs, Tennessee at the 45. First and 10. Stevens comes right. Breaks the first tackle. Give you a little perspective on what's happening with this aggressive Tennessee defense tonight. Coming into this game, Florida had allowed 9 sacks in the season. In this quarter, Tennessee has sacked Rex Grossman 3 times.
Yeah, they've sacked him 3 times, and they've gotten a whole bunch of pressures. 27 times they've gotten pressure on Rex Grossman. That's exactly what they needed to do to put themselves in a position to win.
Second down and 8. 33 seconds to go, third quarter. Draw play. Stevens coming right. Got a terrific block, and he crosses the 50. He'll be 4 yards short of the first down, and third down coming up. Tron LeFevre, number 98, made the tackle.
Tennessee not having nearly the kind of success running the football on the right as they are on the left behind Weary and Coleman. A little more difficult to find yardage for Travis Stevens when they run to the right as the clock winds down here to end the third quarter.
Anything going on in the swamp tonight? That's the end of 3. 23-21. We'll be back in Gainesville after this message and a word from your local station. Gainesville, Florida. Tennessee trailing by 2. First play of the fourth quarter. Casey Clawson in the ball. Look at a 3rd and 3 from the 48. Listen to the crowd. Like a white noise.
Movement.
Flag on the far side.
See, the biggest problem the crowd noise presents is twofold. It's communicating any changes or protection
calls. Movement by the offense. 5 yards, still 3rd down.
Communicating any protection changes or audibles to everybody up front. And then also your offensive linemen can't hear the snap count and pass protection. They've got to watch the football. Fred Weary, he's saying, let's go. Or he wants to know what the snap count is. And
3rd and 8. Shotgun.
Now Casey will clap on this one. The center knows once he sees the clap, he can snap it.
Low snap, but Clawson controls it. Pressured right, off balance, thrown, completed, but short of the first down. I think, let's see where the spot comes. Bobby Graham with the catch. It will be 4th down, so now decision time for Philip Fulmer.
Well, this is a silent count. You clap, the center sees, and then he gets in a rhythm and knows he can snap it. The other linemen have to watch the football. And Alex Brown, who has been very quiet, they had him on the other side, not working on Coleman, but working the opposite side on Openhusel. And he's able to get a little pressure on Clawson.
Time is called by Tennessee. Back in Gainesville, Tennessee will go for the first down on 4th and 1. Travis Stevens is the deep back in the eye. Double tight end set. Now Stallworth moves up on the line and Witten goes in motion. Play action. Here's Clawson rolling out on the bootleg. He's got a 1st down.
Crazy legs. He ran the bootleg against Alabama for a score. He ran it against Notre Dame for a score. And he runs it for a huge 1st down right here. Now everybody's pinching inside for the Gators. They're thinking Travis Stevens for sure. You got to sell the fake, hide the ball, which he does. Everybody pinches inside, and then Casey does the right thing. Just get the first down and get down.
First down comes at the 43. I formation now. 23-21. Clawson out of the backfield. Travis Stevens plants his leg and cuts back to the left and motors down to the 36-yard line where Bam Hartman makes the tackle.
No, that was, I want to go back to that fourth down call because that was a great call by Randy Sanders going with the bootleg. In the last couple years, they've had a couple short yardage plays that have really hurt them. And the loss in 99, they had a fourth and three, and Jamal Lewis was stopped with about 3 minutes left. And then last year, they had a third and one at the Florida 47 with 2.5 minutes left and got stopped. That time, they got the conversion.
They had a three-point lead on that play a year ago, and Florida went 91 to win. Here goes Stevens. Travis Stevens chased by Johnson. Knocked out of bounds at the 2-yard line.
Just a great cut by Travis Stevens. He hits this thing inside. He puts his left foot in the ground and makes a great cut to the outside. Now watch this cut by Travis Stevens. It's to the left again, behind Weary. Now watch. He's going to plant his left foot and cut it back outside. Good job blocking on the backside, sealing off the defenders, but an excellent cut and good vision by Travis Stevens. Jason Witten, the tight end, with a big block on the play.
That one a 34-yard gain. Stevens with 161 yards.
This would be a good place to throw right here for Casey Clawson. First down.
Hands it off instead. Touchdown, Tennessee. Jabari Davis. And the Volunteers fight back to reclaim the lead.
Jabari Davis, the true freshman out of Stone Mountain, Georgia, Tucker High School, 6 foot, 230 pounds, and watch him go airborne. The big back, and again, the good push on the left side. When Tennessee wants to run the ball, they run it to the left.
And the Volunteers have opted to go for two. With a four-point lead at 27-23.
I don't understand this. Why go for two right now? They're leading by four, so Florida needs a touchdown anyway. Two only puts them up by six, and it's 13 minutes left. I think it's too early to do this.
Stallworth in motion. There's a bad exchange, and the ball recovered.
It was obviously a trick play of some sort. They had Stallworth in motion, and the snap hits him right in the butt. That's not the way you draw it up. But Tennessee still with a four-point lead, thanks to the Jabari Davis up and over the top.
Previous games, it was 23-21. And now 27-23, that was the score by which Florida defeated Tennessee last year. Casey Clawson, high school tonight.
He's managed things. You know, and that when the crowd really got fired up there on that drive, he did a great job of making sure he communicated to all of his players.
Alex Walls with the kickoff. This will be taken by Leto Shepard. And Shepard comes to the right. Out to the 22-yard line. 12:57 to go in the fourth quarter of play, and this is one of those games that has certainly lived up to its billing.
It really has. You know, we've seen both quarterbacks really play well. Rex Grossman, the Heisman candidate, but Casey Clawson, you know, ever since the second half of the LSU game, after John Henderson got after him in the locker room, he has played outstanding football, and he has led his team back four times this year in the fourth quarter and trying to do it again today in the most hostile environment he's played in his young career.
On first down and 10, Grossman and the Gators trail by four. Play fake. Grossman gets a good block, drills it out. Caught. And Rishay Caldwell circles out of trouble and is knocked out of bounds. It looked like it was going to be intercepted.
Well, it was intercepted. I mean, Teddy Gaines had this football. And how he dropped it, or how it bounced out, and that's the second time now in the second half that Tennessee had interceptions and couldn't capitalize. Watch Teddy Gaines cut right in front of this throw. He's in perfect position. and it gets into his shoulder pads and bounces out, and Caldwell with the concentration. But you don't get these opportunities very often. And twice now in the second half, Tennessee had opportunities to intercept Grossman and couldn't come away with the ball.
That's a gain of 22. First down is Gillespie. Scoots through right guard out near the 50-yard line. Tackled at the 48. Sunday on 60 Minutes. Remember when only artists drew profiles? Now law enforcement officers draw them too. Is that a good thing? Well, it depends. That's Sunday on 60 Minutes. Second down, six. 12:20 to go in this one. Second-ranked Florida at home against fourth-ranked Tennessee.
Teddy Gaines. Yeah, he needs to forget that play and still play defense. Here he is up here. He's got to get that one out of his head because he's on Jabbar Gaffney right now.
And that's the direction that Grossman will go. Gaffney, first down inside the 30.
Well, this was not man-to-man. This was zone defense. And Tennessee only rushed four. It was picked up well by the Florida offensive line. But watch, Teddy Gaines is just going to turn over Gaffney to the safety. He rides him, and then he turns him over. And Gaffney finds the hole in the middle of the defense. Good read by Rex Grossman.
And for the 10th time in 11 games, Rex Grossman has surpassed 300 yards. 312 is total for the night at this point. Caldwell is in motion. There's play action against Grossman. He's going to be caught. Fumble.
That's going to be a fumble.
Yes. No.
Oh, they're calling him down.
Al Ford ruled him down.
Now, this is a bad decision by Rex Grossman. He doesn't make many, but sometimes you just got to give the other team credit. They beat you. They made a play. They're ruling him down. Or that his momentum stopped. I don't know that his knee's down. Two times tonight, Rex Grossman has gotten away with a bad decision of being not protecting the football.
Second down and 20. Grossman is back across the middle. That little outlet pass to the 35-yard line. The catch made by Gillespie again. That's going to leave third and 15. Let's go back and check this play again.
Yeah, well, his knee was not down, but they ruled that his momentum had stopped because they called it a sack.
Sometimes this is a subjective sport.
Yeah. It wasn't an incomplete pass. It was ruled a sack. But the bottom line is Tennessee and Philip Fulmer's defense has gotten after Rex Grossman. And that's exactly what he said they were going to do.
Florida has called time.
And they only have one left.
Third and 15. Take another look. Was he stopped or was he not? Back in Gainesville, where the Gators face third and 15 from the Tennessee 36. Grossman with an empty backfield. Three receivers wide right. Two off to the left. Here's the toss left side, and he overthrows Gillespie. And during the timeout, Al Ford was getting an earful from Philip Fulmer.
Well, really, he deserves to get an earful because I think there were two plays that have both gone against. The call went against Tennessee. In one case, it should have been a lateral, I think. In that case, it should have been a fumble and not a sack. But Philip Fulmer's defense comes through again on third and long.
So now they're going to call on Jeff Chandler for a 52-yard field goal. His career long is 54. Here's Brian Stone putting it down, and Chandler knocks it way downfield and right through the uprights. Had more than enough. We'll be right back.
Is the Jets' unsung hero having an MVP season? Plus, what's up with Peyton Manning? Sunday on CBS.
10:30 to go, fourth quarter. Tennessee up by one in this battle that has taken place on a teeter-totter before more than 85,000 at the Swamp in Gainesville. Here's the kick. Short. Scott gets it at the 11 and goes right down at the 22-yard line. Leonard Scott. And let's go down to Jill Arrington.
Well, this is the last home game for the Florida seniors and therefore their last game here in the Swamp. And it's been a long, tough road for some of them. They're excited about today's game. Jeff Chandler, he fought the NCAA for eligibility to play another year. Andre Davis battled back from a tough injury. Alex Brown, he could have gone to the NFL last year for the big bucks, but decided to stay at Florida to try for a national championship team. And Zach Zadalis came back for a sixth year, and he's had an injury-plagued career. They'd like nothing better than a victory today.
All right, Jill, they trail by one right now at home. Tennessee, Casey Clawson, Travis Stevens, who's had a wonderful game, and he amplifies that statement by breaking Gus Scott's tackle. And here goes Stevens. Amazing. 68 yards.
He's not big, but he is tough, and he runs hard. But just the blocking downfield again to the left. The blocking by the left side, Weary and Coleman, the fullback Bartholomew, and then busted tackle. Ran right through the tackle of Gus Scott, one of the best players on this Florida defense.
On a rainy night in September, he gained 206 against Arkansas. He's got 227 now. First down and goal, Tennessee. Stevens, that's Jabari Davis, number 31. Travis Stevens gets a well-deserved rest.
I talked about which front seven would be able to dictate the flow of the game, and you would know that by who stopped the run and who pressured the quarterback. And so far, Tennessee, their defensive front seven has fared much better than the Florida front seven. They haven't stopped Travis Stevens, and they haven't pressured Casey Clawson all night.
Second and goal from the five, Bartholomew, the fullback. Jabari Davis is the deep back in the eye. He gets the handoff, follows Bartholomew's block, and struggles down to the one-yard line. Andre Davis makes the tackle. Well, Phil Fulmer told Jill Arrington when he came out of the locker room, they haven't stopped us
yet.
That's
right. The turnover is really the only thing that has stopped the Tennessee offense.
10 out of the last 11 years, the team that has rushed for more yards has won.
They're going to run. They better run left. That's the place where they've had their success.
Bartholomew in motion. They go right. They've got a touchdown.
I know nothing.
But I still listen to you very
baby.
Closely.
That is Tennessee football. The big run by Travis Stevens. They get inside. And they power it down there with their big back, Jabari Davis. Fleming with the lead block. Nice block by Fleming on Andre Davis. And Jabari Davis in for the end zone.
It was set up by Travis Stevens, 68-yard scamper. Alex Walls with the extra point. The Tennessee Volunteers jumped out to a 14-0 lead. Fell behind at the half by six. They've regained the edge by eight. Now let's take a look at the CBS Sportsline stat of the game. Rushing yards, Tennessee with 251, Florida with 21. For complete college football coverage, go to cbs.sportsline.com or AOL keyword CBS Sportsline.
Oh, that's been one of the telling statistics in this series, except for last year. Since 1990, the team that won the rushing battle won the game. Last year, Tennessee outrushed Florida 203-39, but still found a way to lose the game.
Here's the kick from Walls. Leto Shepard drifts over, stays inbounds, and here comes the count punch. He's got some room after the 41-yard line. Alex Walls, the kicker, made the tackle.
Well, they pretty much kicked it deep and kept it away from Lito until this one. And Shepard does a nice job of knowing where the sideline is when he fielded the kick, and there's no white jerseys around him. It was a low line drive kick. And good field position for Florida, who, by the way, only trails by 8.
And recall, if you will, that here's the handoff to Richey Caldwell. Fights his way out to the 50-yard line.
I think Richey made that decision on his own. I think it was supposed to be a double reverse, and he saw the defense had it and kept it on his own.
I think it might have. There's a flag down now.
They may not have had the right number of guys on the line of scrimmage again.
Spurrier sending Taylor Jacobs in with a call. And here's Al Ford.
Offense had 7 men on the line of scrimmage, no penalty. Second down.
They did.
Well, let's go back to that decision to go for 2 points.
Yeah, not the last touchdown, but the one before. And it was a mix-up on the snap count. It hit Dante Stallworth. They didn't even get the play off. But had they kicked the extra point there and gone up by 5, they would now find themselves up by 9 instead of 8. And in that case, Florida would have had to score twice to take the lead instead of now just a touchdown and a 2-point conversion.
Second and 1, Grossman. Hit as he lets it go again. He's got Jacobs. Good downfield coverage, and Rex Grossman was hammered.
John Henderson, he's been quiet. He's been moving around. They've been doing a pretty good job of containing last year's Outland Trophy winner, but this time right in the face of Rex Grossman. And that is a big man to have barreling down at you. 6'7", 290. And take a look. Which front seven has had the better of it today? I'd say Tennessee. Look at that. Only 28 yards rushing they've allowed. And look at the quarterback pressure. 28-4 and 0 sacks for the Florida defense.
Third and 1 at the 49. Quick set up and the pass incomplete to Gaffney. Fourth down.
Tennessee was waiting for that. The quick slant, and Tennessee knew it was coming. But Grossman has been under pressure all day. From the very first series, Tennessee has made a decision that they were going to come after Rex Grossman. Philip Fulmer said, somebody's band's going to play quick. It wasn't the Florida band, because Tennessee got after him early, and they've stayed with the same philosophy.
And now Florida looks at a 4th and 1.
Well, and there's a lot of time left. I mean, Steve is going to go for this, but there's 7 minutes and 30 seconds left, and he's only down by 8.
Movement. Yeah. The tight end on the left side.
Now he's going to punt the football.
Aaron Walker.
Now he's going to punt and try to play defense.
And somehow stop Travis Stevens.
Yeah, find a way. Here's the Walker is the moving guy. The tight end's just going to rock back in his stance. There's the movement right there. You realize Tennessee hasn't had to punt tonight?
That's right.
I mean, the only time they've been stopped is when they've stopped themselves with turnovers.
Matt Leach is on to punt for only the 2nd time tonight. He went through 2 games when he had no punts. This one off the side of his foot. Not good. It does take a Florida bounce and will drift inside the 20 and come to rest at the 15-yard line. 42-yard punt with 7:19 remaining. Now, next Saturday, a college basketball doubleheader for you. Began with top-ranked Duke at Michigan, then North Carolina visits Kentucky. College basketball on the home of the NCAA Basketball Championship.
Now, we showed you those rushing graphics for Tennessee. Coming into the game, Florida, the number 6 team in the country, only giving up 86 yards per game.
Here's Travis Stevens, stuffed this time.
Now, again, a lot of time left. 7 minutes left. And Tennessee can't afford to get ultra-conservative here. I mean, they've got to try to make a couple first downs and run some more clock, because this is a lot of time for Steve Spurrier and Rex Grossman in this Gator offense. Use the clock, milk as much as you can, but don't get conservative right now. Your game plan has worked so far. Don't stray from it.
2nd and 10. Stevens behind the block of Bartholomew stopped at the 19-yard line. Andre Davis. The Rigid Tool Scholar Athlete Award for today's game goes to the University of Tennessee's number 96, John Finlayson. Rigid Tool's commitment to the investment of our future shown today by donating $1,000 to the University of Tennessee's General Scholarship Fund. Finlayson, a senior agricultural economics and business major with a 3.67 grade point average. Third and 11.
Tennessee 5 of 10 on third down in the ball game tonight. But this is a long yardage situation.
Clawson gets the snap. Blitz throws it down low. The catch is made. But not enough for the first down.
Bobby Graham has had a nice game for Tennessee. He's been the inside slot receiver, and he's made some nice plays. Nice catch. Got the left hand underneath the football. He bobbled it a little bit, but he was able to get the left arm underneath the ball.
Fourth and one, and for the first time tonight, we see Dustin Colquitt. Smokey's a little concerned.
And Dustin can't afford to have a bad kick here. I hope he's loose, because he needs to help his defense out with a good kick.
Leto Shepard back to return it. The lefty sails it high. Shepard at the 30.
Nice, nice coverage.
Stop is made by Jabari Greer, a 46-yard punt, 3 on the return. And with exactly 5 to go in this scintillating encounter, the Gators, ranked number 2 in the land, get the ball back, trailing the 4th-ranked Tennessee Volunteers by 8. Tennessee jumped off to a 14-0 lead. There is a flag down, and apparent personal foul is going to be called against Tennessee.
Oh, boy. You get a good punt, your defense has got momentum, and now you give the Gators the ball right about the 50-yard line. Phil Fulmer wants an explanation. A very, very costly penalty against the Volunteers.
First and 10, Florida. Richey Caldwell in motion, gets the handoff. Here's the double reverse, and the throw back to Gillespie. Not a lot of room. It only works to the 41. That one really didn't develop like they'd hoped.
Well, that's the play they called earlier, and Richey saw it wasn't going to work, and so he kept the ball. This time, and this is a dangerous play. I mean, you know, they're going to bring him in motion, give it to him, and then Gaffney's going to end up throwing it back to Gillespie. You got the ball changing hands 3 times, but watch Tennessee respond. The speed of their defense, Mark Jones with the play to keep it to a relatively short game.
Second down and 1. Play action, Grossman. Almost picked off. There was contact with Gaffney and the defender Greer. No flag.
And that is 2 times that Jabari Greer has had a chance to make an interception. That one a little tougher than the earlier one he had. But 3 times the Tennessee defense has been in position to make a pick. You know, the thing I say all season, why some guys are defensive backs and other guys are wide receivers, they're just not used to making catches. And Jabari Greer knew he had a chance to slam the door right there.
Third down, 1 at the 42-yard line. They'll give it to Gillespie. He comes right. First down, Florida at the 35. The clock with 4:10. And let's go back to Tim Brando in New York for this Oregon State, Oregon update.
Well, Oregon certainly looking for help. 2,204 yards, no touchdowns, and a fumble for Joey Heisman.
Grossman back. Here's the deep throw for Gaffney. That's up for grabs and incomplete. And a flag is down at the 40.
Yeah, we're going to have holding on Florida. Again, the pressure has been relentless. The pressure has just been relentless. I think we got Zach Zadalis with
holding
a hold right in the middle.
10 yards from the previous spot. Repeat first down.
Watch right here. Watch Zach Zadalis. He's got a man right over his head, and there goes the takedown. Got the arm underneath. Maybe could have got Rob Roberts as well.
8th penalty, 1st and 20.
But it's been the pressure. I mean, Tennessee has done what they needed to do. They have beaten them up front. Over 30 times, they have gotten pressure on the quarterback.
And a first down 20 from the 45 now with 3:49 to go. Grossman, Rich A. Caldwell. Got the yardage back to the 30-yard line. A gain of 15. Andre Lott with the tackle. Tomorrow, Marcus Allen will sit down with Curtis Martin, the heart of the New York Jets. Is he headed to an MVP award? That and more tomorrow on the NFL Today. My goodness. Second down. Grossman comes right side.
Play other side.
Yes, it is. And Rich A. Caldwell has a Florida first down at the 23 with 3:08 to go.
And Steve Spurrier is the only coach in America that I ever see do that. He'll call the same play two times in a row if he doesn't think the defense will do a better job of stopping it. And a pretty good idea to let Rex Grossman get rid of the ball quick. You know, one of the things, the values of those quick screens is that the quarterback doesn't have to hold it and take a hit.
Now Brian Hagebrook, a fifth-year senior, is on the field, number 15, in a slot to the left.
What's set up, too, is they might throw a quick screen and let that guy throw it again.
First and 10, Florida. Here comes the blitz. Grossman back. He goes for Gaffney, right side. Double coverage, tipped and incomplete.
Good coverage. Good coverage that time. Jabbar Gaffney, the go-to guy. That's Julian Battle, who's a tall defender. He's 6'3". He's a strong safety. He's in perfect position. And Jabbar Gaffney, all he can do is try to prevent the interception.
Grossman for the night, 47 throws, 29 completions, and about 115 hits.
Yeah.
He has been knocked around. Second down and 10. He's back. Little underneath pattern, Gillespie. Breaks the tackle and is down to the 15. That will bring up a third down. Andre Lott thought he had him, number 30.
Had another hit to Rex Grossman. He took a good one on that one. But they set up the screen. I mean, that was designed to let people in and then jump it to the back, Gillespie. But watch Grossman take a hit at the end of the play again. He's been knocked on the ground more times tonight than I bet at least half the season combined, if not all the season.
Third down, Grossman, quick setup. Gaffney turns at the 10. First and goal, Florida, with 2:03 to go. And the Gators have one timeout left.
One-on-one coverage. It's a quick three-step drop, so he doesn't have to hold it long. And a lot of respect. Again, that's Julian Battle, who is really a strong safety out there against the best cover or receiver for Florida, Jabbar Gaffney.
First and goal, Florida at the 7.
Watch the back of the end zone.
Caldwell to the right. Here's Grossman. Pumps once for Caldwell. Fires for Caldwell. Makes the catch inbounds. The clock will continue to run at the 2.
Florida has one timeout. They have one timeout left. And we're at a minute 35. So they don't need to use it right now, because one of the things you want to do is you don't want to let Tennessee have much time with the football if you do score and tie this game up. And remember, Florida needs a touchdown and a two-point conversion.
Caldwell to the right. Perez in a slot to the right. Here's Grossman. Pump, fire, caught it.
Likely guys you'd expect, but he runs a nice zag right outside. He stopped like he was running a hook, and then he broke it outside, and Rex Grossman found him by the pylon.
Now the try for 2 in the tie. It's 34-32, and Florida will spread them out. This for the tie. Snap is back. Pressure fires it. Incomplete.
Credit the coverage. Excellent coverage in the end zone. Now remember, you don't have much depth to defend. So watch watch as this play unfolds. Nobody is going to be open for Rex Grossman. Nothing, 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 nothing. The only guy open was Gillespie on a dump off, but Grossman didn't find him. And again, the pressure gets to him and forces the throw. And Tennessee's defense, the best play of the night.
70 seconds remaining in this one in the Swamp.
Time now for the Exxon and Mobil scoring recap, and this one might take a while. Tennessee jumped on top by 14 points, then Florida fought back, got a touchdown from Grossman. This field goal from Chandler made it 14-10. Florida went on top when Gaffney got that score. Another field goal gave the Gators a 6-point halftime lead, but Travis Stevens has had a wonderful night. He scored a touchdown. Chandler came back. You still with us? Here's another touchdown, Tennessee. Another Chandler field goal. Then Jabari Greer, Davis rather, gets a touchdown. And the last one, this was Carlos Perez. And the extra point try for two did not work.
Now Florida's going to try the onside kick. And if you're Tennessee, these front 10 guys, they have to go get the football. They can't be passive here. The front line maybe tries to block the Gators coming down. The back line needs to aggressively go and foul on the football. Catch the football first.
Now both Petrovich and Chandler are up at the ball. Which of the two kickoff men will kick this one? It'll be Petrovich. It bounces, and it is retained by Tennessee.
John Finlayson, the big blocking tight end, makes his most important catch of the season. Catches it at the top of its jump. For the season, Finlayson had two catches coming into the game tonight. He had two more tonight, but that one, the biggest catch he's ever made.
Florida can stop the clock just once. Here's Clawson, takes a knee. And with 1:01 remaining, the Gators call their final timeout. It has been 1971 when Tennessee last won here.
And they came in as nearly a 3-touchdown underdog. And you don't think that got under the skin of the Tennessee Volunteer coaches and players? They said, hey, wait a minute. We came in here playing for the SEC Championship and a chance to play in the Rose Bowl, too.
Time has been called, but we'll be right back. 61 seconds to go. Second down. Florida cannot stop the clock. There's a flag on the near side of the field, so the clock will stop. Sometimes you got to be careful with the live mics. Offside.
5 yards, repeat, second down.
We didn't think it could get any crazier after last weekend. You know, with the Nebraska losing to Colorado, Oklahoma losing to Oklahoma State. What does this mean? It means Tennessee, Oregon, and the winner of Texas and Colorado later on tonight is still alive, along with Nebraska, to face Miami in the Rose Bowl. Unbelievable season.
Final 45 winding down in the Swamp, which is apparently on the cusp of being drained by the Volunteers. Casey Clawson.
What a job he did. Managing the offense, keeping his composure, and Philip Fulmer, the monkey, is off his back.
Last time he walked off this field as a Victor, he was an offensive guard. He's put on a couple of pounds since then. Steve Spurrier told us yesterday there is an enormous amount of respect between these two programs. And he heads out to shake Philip Fulmer's hands. And Jill Arrington is with Steve Spurrier. Jill?
Coach Spurrier, awful upset for you. What happened out here today?
Well, they ran it down our throat pretty good. We didn't stop the run, and we didn't run very well. And we didn't have a very good two-point play on. But we had to kick field goals. And when you kick a lot of field goals, a high-scoring game, sometimes you lose. That's sort of what happened.
All right, Coach, thank you. Vern?
All right, thank you, Jill. There's a touching moment. Philip Fulmer and his wife, the parents of three daughters, one of whom, the oldest, is here tonight. Rex Grossman, will this dash his Heisman hopes? Travis Stevens, a career-high 226 yards tonight, coming on only 19 rushes. Let's go back to Jill Arrington, who is with Philip Fulmer.
Coach Fulmer, you smell like Gatorade, a huge win for you. Where does this rank amongst your amazing wins at Tennessee?
Well, it certainly has to be right up there with the best of them. You know, I am so proud of this football team. I kept telling them we haven't played our best football, and I think there in the second half we played our best football. And this team's been through a lot this year, but by gosh, now we've got a chance to go represent the East, and you know, who knows what's next. We've got to enjoy the heck out of this tonight, certainly, but get our feet back on the ground and be ready to go again.
Well, congratulations, Coach. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Vern.
Our congratulations to the Tennessee Volunteers and Philip Fulmer. We will see them in Atlanta next Saturday night. Tennessee comes in as 18-point underdogs and knocks off the second-ranked Florida Gators. First win here in 30 years. Tonight on CBS, we'll begin with Rugrats, and then Rugrats again, followed by, ironically, Touched by an Angel, and then The District. That's the compelling lineup tonight on CBS. Well, we trust you enjoyed it. Terrific game for Casey Clawson, Travis Stevens, the Tennessee Volunteers. For Jill Arrington, Todd Blackledge, I'm Vern Lundquist saying goodbye from the swamp in Gainesville, where Tennessee has emerged victorious. See you next Saturday night, everybody.